This is a production of SDPB.
Touchdown! This is for a state championship. Oh, direct kick, and it's good!
There's going to be some highlights coming off of this.
The short-range jumper.
Edging out in lane four, the top seed.
This South Dakota High School State Championship event is conducted under the direction of the South Dakota High School Activities Association.
And welcome back to the Pentagon here in Sioux Falls. We're at Heritage Court for day three of the girls' AA basketball tournament here on SDPB3. Good afternoon to you. Good morning to everybody out in the western part of the state. Along with Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toom. Great to have you here today. We have the final day of the girls' basketball season today. We'll start things off with our seventh place game, a West River matchup between Stevens and Spearfish. And it's Pierre and Mitchell, an ESD grudge match for the fifth place game. That's the first of four games today here on SDPB3. As you see our lineup for today, the Spartans, the 6th seed, taking on the Raiders of Rapid City Stevens. And it's the Mitchell Colonels taking on their rivals, the Governors of Pierre T.F. Riggs High School. That is the afternoon bracket for this final day of the tournament. We move on to championship Saturday night. We start off third place, Harrisburg against the Cavaliers of Sioux Falls Jefferson. And then for all the marbles, the championship game, the unbeaten O'Gorman Lady Knights taking on the Brandon Valley Lynx, a team that's been on a heck of a winning streak. We'll talk about more about that tonight. And here's how the teams made it into championship Saturday. O'Gorman got a scare from Stevens, went overtime before the Lady Knights prevailed, and then they used a massive third quarter last night, Nate, to pull away from Jefferson.
Yeah, it was an impressive just overall half. They were rolling on all cylinders, and you almost feel like they got a little bit of a wake-up call on Thursday, and were playing at a really high level last night.
And then Brandon Valley just shut down Harrisburg last night in that second semifinal, 51-36. Harrisburg really struggling on offense. That sets up the championship match and the third place match coming up tonight. The coverage starts at 6 Central, 5 Mountain Time. But we got business to take care of this afternoon. Let's start it off. Seventh place game, Spearfish against the Raiders of Rapid City Stevens. The Spartans are led by Dakota Johnson as they are making their first tournament appearance in 10 years. As they beat Stevens back on December 21st by 1 point, 49-48. Spartans also have a win over Harrisburg on the season, and then they beat Aberdeen Central in convincing fashion in the SODAC 16 round. They fell behind early in the first both games they've had so far. They're going to have to turn it around today. Sophie Miller, Josie Dana, Addie Reiners, Kate Scharf, and Mariah Bowman. That's the starting lineup for the Spearfish Spartans. Let's meet the Raiders of Rapid City Stevens. Adam Dannenbring, he came so close to pulling that upset.
Yeah,
first round.
Yeah, they were right there, and a lot of their success and their comeback in that game was derived off the 3-point line. They were 9 of 23 overall from three against O'Gorman, only 1 of 6 yesterday versus Pierre. Huge difference in those two games, and huge difference in the outcomes.
Yep, they beat Rapid City Central in the SODAC 16 round to get to the state tournament. Let's meet the starting lineup. For the Raiders, it's Brittany Jones, Talia Porter, Finley Love, Isabel Higgins, and Hallie Peterson. Higgins with 28 rebounds so far. She is the top rebounder in the tournament, and she has been a spark plug at that forward position, the 5'8 senior. You see that the Raiders, they've been frequent visitors, no state titles. They've had runner-ups in 76 and 79 back in the two-class system. Stevens runners-up in 2010, 2021, and 2022. Spearfish, they got fifth place back in 2013. They did qualify in 86 as an A team. That was, I believe, the last year of the AB system. They've been here in 93, 95, 2005, and 2013, 2014. And the appearances for Spearfish. We're just moments away from our pregame ceremonies and the introduction of the starting lineups. Our public address announcer for the tournament is Mr. Greg Thompson. We will turn things over to him. We'll get the party started right here on SDPB3.
Good morning, basketball fans. The South Dakota High School Activity Association welcomes you to this session of the State Girls AA High School Basketball Tournament. This tournament is being conducted under the guidance and regulation of the South Dakota High School Activities Association for the enjoyment and benefit of high school students. Good sportsmanship is essential for the success of these programs. We hope you'll enjoy the game, support your athletes in a positive and sportsmanlike manner. Our first game features the Spartans of Spearfish and the Raiders of Stevens. Will you please stand, remove your hats, as we honor America with the singing of our national anthem. Singing today is Michaela Jones and Sydney Birch from Eureka High School. Ladies and gentlemen, our national anthem.
Stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave.
And now, let's meet the starters for today's games in alternating fashion. For the Spartans at guard, a 5'5 senior, number one, Sophie Guthmiller. For the Raiders at guard, a 5'6 junior, number one, Brittany Jones. For the Spartans at guard, a 5'6 junior, number 10, Josie Dana. For the Raiders at guard, a 5'8 junior, number 3, Talia Porter. For the Spartans at forward, a 5'8 senior, number 20, Addie Reiner. For the Raiders at guard, a 5'5 sophomore, number 11, Finley Love. For the Spartans at guard, a 5'7 sophomore, number 23, Kate Sharp. For the Raiders, at forward, a 5'9", senior number 20, Isabel Higgins. And for the Spartans, at guard, a 5'6", junior, number 32, Maya Kochutin. For the Raiders, at guard, a 5'6", sophomore number 23, Hallie Peterson. The Spartans are led by Dakota Johnson, assistant coaches Jamie Bentley, Jamie Center, and Remy Wenches. Leading the Raiders, Adam Dannenbring, assistant coaches Tanner Waggy, Quintrell Porter, Seth Keane, and Gerald Johnson. Your officials for this game, Kevin Talley, Scott Whitlock, and Connor Singhuysen.
For basketball, grudge matches this afternoon, rivalries. Our first game, Stevens and Spearfish, longtime rivals out in the Black Hills. Spearfish, the road uniforms.
Stevens in the home whites, and it will be the Spartans who control the tip.
And both of these teams in their two previous games have struggled with turnover issues, and there's a nice slip. Good fine way to start that off.
Bowman with the first bucket, the 6 foot senior, averages 5.5 points, 4.5 rebounds per game. She's heading off to play volleyball. School of Mines in Rapid City. Great all-around athlete.
Here you see Spearfish dropping back into a little 1-3-1 half-court trap.
Nice play by Higgins to save it on the miss by Peterson. The shot clock doesn't reset. Under 10 now. Porter lobs it in, but it's swiped by Spearfish. And a man for the Raiders to open things up. Bowman, the free throw line jumper off the mark, and there's Jones with the rebound.
And Bowman showed the ability to knock that shot down yesterday once, banked in a three-pointer once, and there's two consecutive turnovers for the Raiders.
Almost got the layup, but here's a short-range jumper by Scharf. That is good, and a quick timeout by Adam Dannenbring as the Spartans have jumped out to a 4-0 advantage, and coach not happy with his team's performance here in the early moments of this contest.
No, anytime you start off a game like they've started off with a couple of quick turnovers, a lot of the times it can come back to the focus level and your readiness to play, and I'm sure that's what Coach Dannenbring's talking about right now. We're still at a state tournament. These are high-level competitors, both coaching staffs and players. You want them to compete at a high level regardless of whether it's a seventh and eighth place game or a state title.
I mean, this is the last game of the year, and everybody wants to send your seniors out with a W. Doesn't matter what time you're playing, you want to end that season on a high note. Only four teams get to in each class.
Yep. Yeah, there's not many that end with a W. There's a lot sitting at home right now that certainly didn't.
Well, volleyball is one, and some of the team sports. You have tournaments where you play it out to each place. Football, for example, only one team in each class gets to go home with a W. Along the baseline, pass slapped out of bounds by Scharf.
Yeah, and the Raiders are struggling right now to get in the basketball where they need to against this active 1-3-1 zone. And here the Spearfish going to match up just man-to-man with the underneath out of bounds.
Talk about rivalry here in the afternoon session. These two teams know each other really well. Same could be said for Mitchell and Pierre going at it this afternoon. That ball was touched.
Shot clock under 10.
Love to Higgins. She doesn't have anything. Porter in the lane finds a way to score.
And Porter, we've seen it all tournament long. She just has such an ability to drive hard to the rim and make good stuff happen.
Trap, ball's tipped, but Bowman bails out the Spartans. Open shooter, Scharf, short. Bounced off the shoulder of Reiners. Here come the Raiders, 2-on-1. They lob it to Porter, up and in.
Nice find and finish there. Higgins with the transition push, draws the defender, drops it off to Talia Porter.
And Higgins taps that out of bounds.
Some quick hands from you there, Steve. That was nice.
Gotta keep a hands up, eyes open. And it'll be Spearfish ball at half court.
Stevens just playing their aggressive man-to-man half-court defense right now.
Layup no good by Dana. Here come the Raiders. A little trouble in the backcourt, but they salvage it. Pourbaix in the lineup. Tapped away from her by Bowman. Here comes Dana. Kicks it back. Kochutin the long shot. Yes, and it's a three. Nice transition by Spearfish.
Yeah, and Kochutin just has a nice, pretty stroke and really shoot it from three. Always playing aggressive.
Oh, what a pass by Pourbaix to set up Higgins in the paint.
And Pourbaix, her activity yesterday wasn't really felt in the scoring column, but finished with, I believe it was 5 rebounds, 3 assists, played a great floor game.
Yeah, didn't score, but made up a contribution in other
ways, and here's Scharf a three. Yes. This is what Spearfish likes to do. They haven't had a chance to display that in the first couple of games, but Spearfish seems to be in a little more of a rhythm.
Yeah, sharing the basketball really well, finding their shooters with Kachutin and Scharf.
Here's Jones lining up a three. No, and the rebound is going to be saved by Dana.
That was a good attack by Finley Love in the gap, drew the defense, kicked.
Just couldn't make the shot, but Jones did have the open look. Now Spearfish on the attack. They'll slow it down. Kachutin scanning things over. She'll drive, lob it up. No, rebound, Higgins. 14 rebounds in each of the first two games for that young lady. She'll launch a three. No. Rebound. Dana pulls it away.
It's a great box out by Josie Dana. She was matched up on Tamaya Poorbear, who had some size and strength on her. And there's Scharf again.
Misses the long three, and Poorbear grabs the rebound, lobs it ahead. And we've got, oh, Peterson dribbled it out of bounds. Timeout on the court, 3:19 left, first quarter, 10-6. Spearfish ahead, back in a moment, right here on SDPB3.
As much as you have accomplished, there are times you'd rather not go it alone. While you determine what direction you go, we're here to help along the way. So go. Go with community. Go with neighbors. Go with understanding. Go with support.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy, so we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Spearfish ahead 10-6 here in the first quarter along with Nate Kading. I'm Steve Toombs, sub in for Spearfish. They're going to the bench. Tearson Grubb, 5'9 sophomore, number 21, checking into the game. She'll give Bowman a rest in that lineup for Spearfish. And here comes Mackenzie Schreiber, number 25, and Jessa Griswold into the game, number 13, for the Raiders. Out of the timeout, Spearfish plays it in at half court.
Anytime you're on your third game in 3 days, you want to try to keep your players as fresh as you can. You've seen both coaches go to their benches here pretty early on in the first quarter.
Yep. Three games in 3 days, those minutes pile up.
Yeah, and it's just something that the teams aren't used to doing a ton. You know, most even tournaments or holiday events or different special events that they're playing, it's, you know, it's a game, maybe two games, but yeah, 3 games in 3 days can take its toll.
Jones all the way short on the jumper, and we're gonna have a double dribble as Griswold got the rebound but was a little bit out of control. Love the hustle from Griswold, but just couldn't finish off that play to find a teammate to save the possession.
Yeah, and so far, one of the big differences in this game is Spearfish, after struggling with turnover issues, having 21 against Mitchell and 19 against Brandon Valley, no turnovers so far.
Dana gets the pass from Kachutin, gives it back to her. 15 on the shot clock. She'll drive, put it up, might have been partially blocked. It ends up in the hands of Porter. Lobs ahead, Poorbear on the run, was bumped. It will not count. On the floor before the shot. Tough break there for the Raiders.
That was a great one-hand snap pass by Talia Porter in transition. And you see her vision, you see her skill level there. One of the most all-around skilled players that we're seeing in this tournament, and only a sophomore.
Porter is a junior.
Junior, yeah. Excuse me. Yeah, sorry.
Second team All-State last year, and a foul on the inbounds play. And you mentioned that we have so many talented underclassmen. We've seen it year after year at the state basketball tournament at different classes as well. And quite a few of these young ladies
probably going to see at the next level.
Yeah, no question about that.
Dana got that last foul.
There's Stevens with a nice line setup, and they split, find Poor Bear with the crafty finish.
Cuts the deficit to two. Oh, near steal. Griswold calling problems, and Dakota Johnson calls the timeout. They were down to 3 seconds left to get it across the timeline. Griswold really creating problems out there.
Yeah, Stevens, even off the bench, when they bring in Griswold, they bring in Schreiber, they don't lose much from a quickness perspective in comparison to Love and Brittany Jones, their other perimeter players. And we've seen it all tournament long. Whenever they have an opportunity to pick up full, they're going to do so and try to wreak havoc.
Don't forget, you can follow SDPB Sports on your mobile device all season long. Check us out on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And be sure to check out all our action and award photos by searching for SDPB on Flickr. Tell us where you're watching us from, and you can read some of our great stories and watch some of our videos that feature the teams, the players, and the coaches here in South Dakota. Out of the timeout. Grubb gets it in the backcourt. And they'll get it ahead to Bowman, who's back into the game. Running the floor nicely is Grubb, and she will get the bucket.
Great pass. Bowman showing some ball handling ability there.
Back to a 4-point lead for Spearfish. Porter on the move. Tries to get inside and puts it up off the window.
Yeah,
she's got six.
Yeah. So good, so strong. You really, defensively, you want to try to take that right hand away from her. She's so elusive going that direction.
Guth Miller on the perimeter, gonna try to drive, fouled on the floor on her approach to the basket. And it's gonna be on Griswold, and that is her first. That is the first team foul against the Raiders. Spearfish plays it in. Guth Miller up at the top of the key. Hands it off. Scharf with the ball. There's Bowman in that high post, guarded by Poor Bear.
Just operating with their half-court man-to-man offense. And the nice turnaround jumper by Bowman with the soft touch. Gets a friendly bounce.
Kind of went around Poor Bear to put up that shot.
Yeah, Coach Dakota Johnson has to love how they've started this first quarter.
Another turnover, Grubb.
Active defensively, valuing the basketball.
Jump ball, possession arrow Raiders. Grubb got ahead of everybody, picked up her dribble, and got into trouble. That's a missed opportunity for Spearfish.
Yeah, right on cue when I say they haven't had any turnovers, and then they create the jump ball.
Porter will run the show, bringing it up court. Shot clock and game clock just about even, maybe a half second difference. But they're going to fire the long shot. Schreiber misses the three. And now Spearfish with the chance for the final opportunity, up by 4 points.
Shot clock off. Look for them to hold for one.
See who wants the basketball. Looking for Bowman, not open. Tapped away from Grubb. She's going to have to launch it. It will not count, even if it had gone in. Spearfish got a little out of sorts there, but they are ahead after one period of play, 14-10 over Rapid City Stevens. This is the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament, and you're watching SDPB3.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
At BankWest, our relationships are everything. They reach beyond banking. We're committed to understanding your vision and upholding your values as partners in your success. building a future filled with opportunity. BankWest.
Some of the fans enjoying the action here at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls, along with Nate Kading. I'm Steve Toom. Great to have you along for the ride. Good morning to everybody out West River. Spearfish and Rapid City Stevens doing battle here for seventh place. Spartans up 14-10.
We had the next generation of the Stevens and Spearfish right there on video for a second. There's a great set play. Fake handoff by Josie Dana keeps it.
That's Dana's first bucket of the game, and if you're Spearfish, you get a six-point lead, and Dana's only scored two. That's good news. That means other players are contributing. Dana with 29 points in the tournament coming into this game, and there's a foul on Spearfish. Maddie Donovan has just checked in. That's Dana, and she's going to collect foul number two. Could be a factor there.
Yeah,
Dana's the only player that scored in double figures for either game for Spearfish. Yeah.
We saw yesterday Coach Johnson has no problem playing them in the first half with two, and a lot of trust in their players to hopefully be smart and not pick up unnecessary ones, and a lot of trust in the bench if they have to go there.
Coach Hooten, by the way, did have 11 points in the first game as Donovan picks up that foul. And Dana's going to check out and Guthmiller in. See what the Raiders can do with the fresh shot clock. We'll throw it into Peterson. She had that big fourth quarter against O'Gorman with 3 three-pointers.
Porter's looking for it inside. Has Donovan on her. Yep, they find.
Foul drawn.
Porter, Donovan gives up. Now we know how hard she competes and we know what type of defender she is, but she's given up about 3-4 inches onto Porter there, and they just lob it over the top. And when Talia Porter catches it right there, your only option is pretty much to foul her, or it's going to be 2 points.
Free throw up and in. Bowman got the foul, her first. Team's third. Kochutin out, Scharf in for the Spartans.
Great balance right now for the Spartans. 2, 4, 3, multiple people scoring the basketball for them.
And the free throw is good. Porter and Sawyer Stabner. I wonder who draws more fouls between those two on the regular season.
You have two very, very physical and skilled guards, and they both just drive it so hard downhill, especially to their right hands.
Ball was tapped out of bounds, and Donovan will play it in for the Spartans just to our left. Guthmiller guarded by Love. Open shooter in the corner is Grubb. Won't take it.
Bowman's posting low, posting hard. Wants it. There they find her.
Fade away off the window. And the rebound collected by the Raiders.
Like that finish to be a little bit more towards the basket and not going away when she releases and shoots it.
Yeah, got to go up, not backwards. Larry Johnson could do the fadeaway, but not many could do it as well as he could. And there's Porter down low, way under the basket. Triple team. And the shot's blocked by Guthmiller. She taps it ahead, but there's Higgins making another
play. Shot clock winding down here.
Yep, it didn't hit the rim. Peterson's got a launch. She doesn't realize it. That's a shot clock violation. And Peterson's saying to her teammate, "I can't hear." Couldn't hear, but the coaches are saying, "Hey, you got to look at the shot clock."
Yeah, you like to have your bench counting down in those situations, but as a player, you always have to have an awareness. You got to understand where the clock is, shot clock, game clock, score, and situation.
And what worked against Peterson is she was in the corner and couldn't really see that shot or the shot clock. We got a foul on the Raiders in the backcourt. Finley Love will collect her first foul. First team foul of the quarter. Remember, fouls reset at the quarter break. You get to 5 and it's the double bonus.
Yeah, right now the small difference in this game is Raiders have 6 turnovers right now. Spearfish still sitting at 0.
Better turnaround by Bowman, but it hit the front of the rim. Higgins had it blocked by Bowman and picked up by Scharf in the backcourt. Try to get it to Love. Sharp free throw line. Jay, no. And there's Porter with the rebound. She's looking to run.
Spearfish back defensively, and there's Donovan getting the steal. Donovan on the move, has a teammate. She takes it and has it tapped out of her hands by Porter.
Donovan's just so good defensively. She's quick laterally, active hands. She competes and plays really, really hard. She's a coach's dream on the defensive side of the floor. That's where Porter may have a size advantage on her inside, but Donovan's got a little quickness advantage when she picks her up on the perimeter.
Duffmiller got fouled on the shot attempt. Free throws coming up. Porbear, and that is her first, team second. Guthmiller to the line. 41% on the year. And got the first. Kochutin in, Donovan out for Spearfish. Got them both. Guthmiller did not score yesterday.
Yeah, Spearfish continues to drop back into their half-court zone.
There's Porter with the ball, double-teamed. Now inside, Porbear has to go to the outside. It's tipped away, but it ends up in the hands of Love.
Another shot clock situation that's winding down. Under there, they find Porter. Yeah, when she gets it right there, oh, this doesn't finish through the contact.
Kochutin gives way to Guthmiller. Now she'll want it back. Raiders extending that defense. Kochutin tries to drive. Guthmiller along the baseline. And I believe she is going to have a foul. And that will take us to a break. Timeout on the court, 4:41 left to go. And it's Spearfish up 18-12. Back in a minute right here on SDPB3.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great. Like 15 pizzas. Yo! Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
A community is more than buildings. It's where you live, where you work. Community is being there for each other. Lending a hand when your neighbors are in need. Community is all of us coming together for a greater purpose. This is community. This is Lloyd.
Brittany Jones got tagged for that foul for Stevens right before we went to the break. It's Spearfish 18, Raiders 12. Along with Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toom. Great to have you here. Final day of the girls' basketball season. State AA basketball tournament. This is the seventh place game. In an all-West River matchup between familiar foes, Spearfish and Rapid City Stevens. And Scharf gets a step and scores.
It was a great misdirection. They lob it over the top to Scharf. Inbounder clears to the other side to open up that driving lane, and just a nice drive and easy two.
Porbear along the baseline gets it into Higgins, has it blocked, tries again, too strong off the window. Spearfish with the rebound. Scharf wants to run.
Spearfish right now, after probably not feeling like they played the greatest in their first two games at this tournament, are rolling on all cylinders, and there's Donovan.
That's her first points of the tournament, and that puts the Spartans up by 11 as they are on a roll. Donovan's been so valuable for them defensively as Porbear's gonna misfire on a three. Well, there's Higgins, blocked by Bowman. Loose on the floor, there's a pileup. Jump ball, possession arrow, Raiders.
Bowman just being an active rim protector right there has impacted the last two possessions inside.
Oh.
When you have a great volleyball player, you know they're going to be a good rim protector.
Oh, yeah.
They know how to block.
Yep, good length, quick off the ground, good timing.
Bowman heading off to the School of Mines to play volleyball.
Another shot clock situation. We're under five.
And that is another shot clock violation. Look at the Spearfish bench cheering on their defense.
Yeah, right now it appears with their activity, how hard they're playing, there's about six or seven defenders out on the floor. They only have five. But that's what it's feeling like. And Stevens right now just being a little stagnant with their ball movement, being a little stagnant with their player movement against this zone. They've struggled solving it here so far.
Yep, and that timeout, a 30-second timeout called by Spearfish. Hey, don't forget that you can become a member of SDPB today. First Bank and Trust, with support from Van and Barb Fishback, are inviting you to support high school sports on SDPB. And your new member donation will automatically be matched, doubling your gift, taking advantage of this match. You can do that right now by donating today to sdpb.org. Call 800-777-0789. We thank you for your support to South Dakota Public Broadcasting throughout the years. Get a look at Donovan on the replay there, hitting that three, back to live action. Reiners with the ball over to Scharf. She's got an angle, but it's blocked by Poor Bear out of bounds. And they're going to say it is a foul. And it's on Poor Bear, hit the player on the head.
Yeah, and that was another isolation play that they ran for Scharf. High post enter. Cleared Bowman from that opposite elbow out, skipped it over, and then Scharf with a hard attack. That time to our right hand, back to the left.
Poor Bear, her second foul. She'll have to check out in favor of Hallie Peterson. Scharf, just a sophomore.
Yeah, and the one thing when you have a shooter like Scharf, you always know any type of closeout situation, you gotta make sure you're respecting her ability to shoot it. And oftentimes it's gonna open up opportunities to drive, and she's really taken advantage of that here lately.
A little bit of pressure at the half court line. Jones works to the right side of the lane. Here's Griswold lining up a three, and he connects. Boy, the Raiders needed that one. And Griswold delivers. Makes it a 10-point advantage for Spearfish. Coach Hutton brings it up court, being hounded by Griswold. Donovan cutting across the lane, but now Bowman up off the window, too strong. Porter pulls down the rebound. Numbers for the Raiders. A couple players for Spearfish fell down. Griswold just couldn't pull the trigger.
Yeah, Donovan did a nice job taking away her daylight.
Here's Higgins.
Nice drive.
Well, that was a good dish, and Higgins just couldn't hit that baseline jumper.
Yeah, Griswold came in off the bench. Second run here today with great energy, great efforts. Kind of sparked them here over the last minute.
Open shooter is Donovan. She'll fire again off the front of the rim. Higgins, another rebound for the Raiders. Jones has to give it up to Peterson. Some good ball movement there. Now Porter going to go down the lane, pull up. Yes. She's got 10.
Yeah, and Stevens, Stevens, the Raiders are having a lot more success right now. When Spearfish misses, they're dropping back into man-to-man, and they're operating a lot more efficiently against their man-to-man than they are against their zone. When they're able to score a bucket or off a dead ball situation, that's when they're dropping back into their half-court zone, which Stevens has struggled against here so far in this first half.
Hey, don't forget, we got boys basketball coming up next weekend. We begin on Thursday, March 14th. Coverage on three channels. Class B will be on SDPB1. Class A is on SDPB2. Here on SDPB3, we'll be covering Class AA, just a little ways away over at the Denny Sanford Premier Center. All the action online at sdpb.org/basketball. And yours truly, I'll be at the AA tournament. Looking forward to that.
Yeah, in Sioux Falls here, it's been the basketball mecca here recently, with the Northern Sun Tournament taking place here. this AA girls tournament, Summit League going on right now, and then AA boys next week.
Yeah, to kind of wrap it all up here, great action. And Rapid City enjoying some action as well with the girls B out there. They'll have boys A out there next weekend at the Monument. And there's a drive and a foul, two free throws coming up. And that is a foul on Higgins, and that will be her first. And Guth Miller at the line, missed that one. And you know, they got the new Monument Arena out there, fine facility. This a fantastic facility, the Sanford Premier Center, great facility, getting kudos from national press, as is the Monument, as is this facility. Guth Miller makes that one. We are fortunate in the state to have such great and iconic venues that we have. And you know, as I've been following basketball since I was a kid, and it's never been better than what we have right now for great venues. There's not a bad seat in the house.
No question. Yeah, you talked about the ability level of the players in here, and the facilities, the opportunities that they have to get better with their high schools, with programs in the off season. They're it's a great area for overall just athletic development.
And there's going to be a foul. I think it's on Kochutin. That is her first on the move by Porter in the paint. You know, a couple of years ago when the NAIA Men's Division II basketball tournament was here, I talked to some of the teams from around the country that don't get to see this facility too often, as Porter makes that free throw, and they loved it. They had nothing but positive feedback. It's too bad that they consolidated down to one division in NAIA. That free throw is up and in, but this building here has impressed pretty much everybody who stepped inside it. Love this place.
Yeah, it's so intimate, right? And we're going to see that here tonight again, just like we did on semifinal Friday. And we'll see the Raiders right here. A minute left, and they've closed this deficit to 7 points, and be an important finish to the half.
Callie Reiner's number 24 checking in for Spearfish. Kochutin the quick three, no. Rebound Jones. She's looking to run. Scanning the court. Nice find of Peterson. Oh, in and out. And finally, it is Reiners, that's Callie Reiners, who collects it. Callie and Addie are sisters. They are both on the court. Addie, 24, or 20, Callie is 24. Long three put up, and it's an air ball. And Kelly Reiners tried to save it. Shot clock will be off with 22.2 seconds left.
Scharf knocked down a three yesterday against Mitchell with that exact same action where she sets a ball screen, receives a flare screen, drifts to the middle of the floor, and that one just came up a bit short.
Tried a Caitlin Clark shot there.
Yeah, that, yep. Yeah,
the logo three. I mean, Steph Curry kind of started that, and now you're seeing other players, men and women, at the collegiate ranks, and it's drifting down in the high school.
Yeah, and we talked.
I gotta say, Josh Mueller hit some of those shots back in the day for West Central, and I saw some of those calling him on radio back in the day for West Central.
Yeah, I think some of that's been around for a long while. It's just maybe the coverage of it hasn't been what it is now.
4 seconds left. Porter in trouble. 5 seconds to call. Good defense by Spearfish.
It's a great job of converging on Talia Porter, and she's been big for the Raiders thus far, has 12 of their 19, 4 or 5 from the floor, and she's going to draw a lot of attention. When she does so, needs to make sure she's looking for her open teammates.
From half court, it's short of the mark, but a great first half for Spearfish. They're ahead at the break, 26-19 over the Raiders of Rapid City Stevens. More from the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament in a moment on SDPB3.
You live life on the move. While you determine what direction that may be, we're here to help along the way. So go. Go with values. Go with friends. Go with support. Go with convenience.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation. So we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
Coverage of the South Dakota High School Activities Association event is made possible by a partnership between the SDHSAA and SDPB. Sponsors of SDPB's coverage include Dakota Bank, South Dakota Corn, and by Lloyd Companies, Bank West, South Dakota State University, the South Dakota Department of Education, and by your membership in the Friends of SDPB.
Spearfish ahead at halftime over Rapid City Stevens, seventh place game, 26-19 our score. You know, in most South Dakota sports bars, you'll see local sports teams displayed on the walls. The Blue Goose in Oneida takes it to another level by not just promoting local teams of the Sully Buttes area, but teams from all over the state.
Welcome to the Blue Goose. Jamie Lamb said, when you do this bar, you got to name it the Blue Goose, because everybody called this old bar in town the Blue Goose, and that was its nickname. And I said, let's do it. We ran with it. We were kind of searching, and it worked, I guess. So it started really simple. We four of us came together. We were just going to kind of have a clubhouse. And we got a liquor license, and I had all this stuff that I've been collecting for years, and I said, let's throw it on the walls and see what happens. And unofficially, the first non-smoking bar in South Dakota. When we opened, we went non-smoking, and which is kind of cool. It was before the law went into effect, but people come in, they feel like they're in somebody's basement or a garage or somewhere with all this stuff, and they walk around, and there's memorabilia from all over the state, so get a lot of old schools and things that aren't even schools that aren't even in, no longer have schools, they're co-ops now, you know, and that's some of the stuff we really like. Mobridge, football jersey, Bronx, you know, every imaginable side of the state people bring in. People come in and they can really relate to, you know, can you believe they wore that short of shorts or that jersey material or whatever, you know? And I've been in the sporting goods world for 30 years selling to colleges and high schools. And so it's kind of it's a passion for me. I love collecting old stuff like that. And people come out of the woodwork and bring us stuff. Java scoreboard donated by the Beal Boys out of Java. Braun Trucking, independent basketball. Lots of old memorabilia, and then helmets. You know, we have a lot of great selection of helmets that have come, and ranging from old leather helmets up to modern day stuff. Well, just like any kid, you started with sports cards, and you know, you bought, sell, trade, and my wife and I collect antiques, and everywhere I went, I was always finding old sports stuff, leather helmets, and things, and I was kind of enthralled in it. I just kept collecting, and the Tim Miles jersey right back there, Dolan High School, I didn't know I had it. Tim's a good friend of mine. He went to college with my wife at University of Mary in Bismarck, and we're having supper. We went to supper with him at the Cattlemen's. We're sitting there. I said, Tim, what was your high school number? And he said, 3233. So I called the bartender. I said, take a picture of that Dolan jersey. I show it to him, and he goes, that's my high school jersey. I got a lot more stuff. It's there's more to come. I've talked with a couple buddies. We've talked about possibly expanding if we can find the right town to another Blue Goose out there somewhere, and spreading the what we have here and into another small town if things would work out right. You know, Oneida is so rich in tradition of state championships, you know, and having good sports teams. And, you know, so after sports events, there's people that come down, they want to talk to sports and the games. And, you know, we have a lot of people in the area that come down here, even they're from the other towns, want to stop and have a pizza and a beer after the games and talk sports. And a lot of people gravitate to here and they say, hey, I got to see the Blue Goose. I heard about this, or, you know, and it's so rich in tradition. And it's a town that, you know, lives and dies on athletics.
SDPB is committed to telling great stories that surround high school sports and activities in South Dakota on a yearly basis. To check out more of our video features, go to sdpb.org/basketball. More from the girls' AA tournament in a moment, right here on SDPB3.
There is a new world out there, revealing itself in unpredictable ways. A world that demands more from the land and those who grow, farm, and build on it. This new world calls for the ingenuity to get more out of it while preserving as much as we can. After all, to stay ahead of tomorrow, we need to be equipped for it today.
Dakota Plains New Holland dealers proudly support high school athletics.
At Bank West, our relationships are everything. They reach beyond banking. We're committed to understanding your vision and upholding your values as partners in your success. Building a future filled with opportunity. Bank West.
We're all going somewhere, going higher, faster, farther, going in new directions to new places. At Monument Health, we keep going so you can keep going. We're dedicated to advanced orthopedic care with the latest innovations, technology, expertise, and treatment. So keep exploring, keep making memories, keep going with Monument Health as your partner. Learn more at monument.health/orthopedics.
Anthem Oats in Frederick is a proud community partner and supports high school activities in South Dakota. The Sumptions have been stewards of the soil since 1882. From the family farm right to your pantry. AnthemOats.com.
First Dakota is here for the shared community experiences, the competition, long-standing rivalries, the players and coaches, seeing friends again, and cheering on our favorite teams. It's what makes life great here, and First Dakota is here for it.
26-19 Spearfish ahead of the Raiders of Rapid City Stevens here at the break. Along with Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toom. Let's check out some of the highlights from that first half. And Spearfish getting off to a great start, going inside to Bowman.
Such a balanced offensive effort for Spearfish. They had eight people contribute in the scoring column in that first half and did a tremendous job taking care of the basketball with zero turnovers.
See Bowman with the shot there, and Porter doing everything she can to keep her team in. But there's Donovan getting a steal to disrupt things. Scharf with the great drive and the finish for Spearfish there. Then Donovan, she can hit the three-pointer in addition to her tough defense.
Yeah, Griswold came in off the bench for Rapid City Stevens and provided some good energy, some good effort, knocked down that three there.
Yeah, from the floor, Spearfish is 9 of 25, 7 of 19 for the Raiders. Rebounding, a big advantage there for Stevens at 18 to 9. But turnovers, 12 for the Raiders. Check that out. No turnovers at all for Spearfish in that first half. Free throws pretty much a wash. And Spearfish playing very, very clean basketball individually. It's Porter with 12 leading the way for the Raiders. Seven, the top scorer, that's Scharf for Spearfish, but Spearfish with a much more balanced attack in the first half.
Yeah, if the Raiders are gonna continue to erase this deficit, they're gonna need to attack the zone when they're set up with Spearfish and then find some other offense along with Talia Porter and certainly need to value the basketball a lot better than they did in the first half.
Josie Dana back into the game. Remember, she sat a good chunk of that second quarter with foul trouble as the defense being aggressive, but Bowman gets the nice pass in the finish.
Great backdoor cut by Bowman. Defender loses vision there. Dana making an instant impact again.
Oh, but she missed the layup. Oh, that could have been an early dagger perhaps for Spearfish, but they miss a golden opportunity.
Dana was running down the floor with a smile on her face. Knew she missed a good opportunity there.
Porter fighting hard, jump ball, possession arrow, Raiders. And it will be Jones to trigger. These teams played back on December 21st. Spearfish won by one. There's Porter trying to tip it to herself. And we're going to have another jump ball. This time the possession arrow favors the Spartans.
That was a quick pass back to Jones. Jones was the inbounder. Quick corner cut right there and ended up with a clean look.
Bowman, she put it on the floor. Has to give away to Dana. Oh, Spearfish nearly mishandled it. Now they'll get into their offense. Reiners in the paint, yes. That's her first points of the entire tournament.
It's a smooth left shoulder finish there from Reiner.
Now Addy normally averages 4.5 points a game. Porter up over Bowman, no good. Scharf with the rebound.
They got numbers if they can find them ahead.
Instead, they'll have to settle into the half court. Guthmiller drives, throws it up, and a quick foul. And that's going to be on Porter, and that is just her first. That was aggressive move by Guthmiller.
Yeah, aggressive move. That was one of those finishes, though, that you really want to try to make them earn, right? I'm not even sure if Guthmiller was necessarily looking to even finish the play with the eyes up. It was more, I'm going to just create this contact, try to draw a foul and get to the foul line. And that's really where you got to make sure your hands are straight up and force them to finish tough plays.
5 points for Guthmiller, all from the free throw line today. And Spearfish has opened up a 13-point lead. Maybe in that zone defense as Jones drives in, tries a bounce pass. Nobody there. Turnover. Raiders. Another turnover for Stevens.
When Stevens closed that deficit in the first half, they were able to play against the Spartans' man-to-man defense, and they're really struggling against this half-court zone that Spearfish sits in, and they're going to need to either get some stops and push so they can play against a man, or do a better job taking care of the basketball against the zone.
Foul was on Finley Love. That is her second. Dana into the front court. Gets around a double team. And we're going to have a bump foul on Porter, who looks astonished. And that will be her second.
Some of those, the further you're away from the basket and on the perimeter, those are the easy ones for the officials. They're gonna allow a little bit more contact around the rim or driving to the rim, but when you're 30 feet away from the basket, it's
another foul as Guthmiller taking it aggressively to the basket again. And that's Griswold with the foul and her second, like that, four team fouls on Stevens within the first 2 minutes here in quarter number three. So Spearfish has the opportunity to potentially get a lot of free throws. That shot will be short of the mark. Rebound, Spearfish fought for. Guthmiller had it, throws it to the outside. Dana misses on the three, and Porter collects the rebound.
Guthmiller just oh, there's Porter again with the great find to Higgins.
Higgins gets
running
the finish.
The floor. Yeah, Guthmiller right now just living in the paint, doing a nice job.
4 points for Higgins. Now here's Bowman posting up. Spins, tries the up and under, yes.
Much better job of Bowman there, finishing towards the basket. She had two at the end of the first half that she was finishing away from. That's a great up and under, explode to the rim in the finish.
Jones with the long shot, in and out. Higgins with another rebound. Misses the putback, Bowman clears it away. Outlet Guthmiller and potential numbers for Spearfish. Reiner's the quick three, but it's off the mark. Rebound Spearfish, Bowman underneath scores. She's got 10.
Sharp off the offensive rebound. Finds a cutting Bowman, and Bowman with the soft touch.
Griswold on the move, missed it, and another rebound for Spearfish. As the Spartans looking to put the hammer down here. Up 38-21.
It's been all Spartans here so far in the second half.
Well, they are a much different team today than they have been the previous two games where they fell behind early. Got time, 10 seconds left as Dana moves along the baseline. Up top, Reiner's quick three. Good off the window!
The bank, the bank's open on the Saturday, Steve?
Who
the
knew?
Bank's open on the Saturday. Things are going right for the Spartans right now.
20-point lead. Here's a three, and it's good by Finley Love. Spearfish playing much better basketball today. They'll lob it inside, and we will have a foul. That foul will be on the Raiders. See who that's on. That's going to be on Higgins, her second. Timeout on the court. We'll step away for a moment. Spearfish in control here in the seventh place game, Class AA Girls on SDPB3.
We're trying to promote the Descendants of Doom tour, you know, trying to make everybody look kind of metal and, you know.
Menacing, menacing.
The band just got covered by Delta Dental, so they kind of can't stop smiling.
They need to look more metal, and they don't look metal. What do we do?
Pop off a few more, see what we get.
Give me some metal. All right, yeah. 3, 2, 1.
Delta Dental!
Oh, my goodness.
Back here at the Pentagon, they got the scoreboard corrected. 39-24, that is the correct score. It is Spearfish on top of Stevens. I'm Steve Toom, he's Nate Kading. Great to have you along for the ride here on a Saturday afternoon at the Pentagon Heritage Court here in Sioux Falls. And Bowman's going to the line for Spearfish.
Yeah, Spearfish still sitting at zero turnovers in the entire game.
How often do you see that?
Oh my gosh, yeah, not often whatsoever, and especially for them after really having some turnover issues in their first two games of this tournament, and then having 21 against Mitchell and then having 19 against Brandon Valley, and their Bowman knocks down the clean free throw, but they are playing really, really impressively right now on both ends of the court.
And that one will bounce away in the rebound to the Raiders. Yeah, they scored 42 in their first game, 43 in their second game total. And we got 3.5 minutes left to go here in the third quarter, and they're at 40 points. Porter gonna drive, has to give it away. Nice extra pass to Griswold, and that's a three, and that's desperately needed by the Raiders.
Yeah, Griswold with the second three of the game.
Raiders as a team, 29% beyond the arc. Griswold, a good shooter from beyond the arc, and there's Bowman with the long counter. She is on fire today. And a steal by Bowman. 14 points for Bowman.
Both teams right now, Spearfish shooting 46% from three and Stevens at 38%. Both groups are knocking down some outside shots.
Bowman got loose underneath, had it blocked, puts it on the floor, up again, off the window too strong. Who's got it? It's gonna be the Raiders. Peterson got it. Oh, almost threw it behind her out of bounds. She'll get it across the timeline. Griswold, another three. She's feeling hot and hits another one.
Feeling really good right now. A little dribble handoff action, stops and pops.
Schreiber in the game, guarding Kochutin out on the perimeter. Trying to get to the baseline, and there's going to be a foul on the Raiders. And that's Schreiber, her first.
And as you mentioned, they're going to be at the line the rest of this quarter. So they want to stay aggressive into bodies, attack that heart of the defense, get themselves into the paint.
Missing the free throw is Kochutin, normally a good shooter at 86%. Bowman's going to get a break, so will Scharf. Coming in, Donovan and Grubb for Spearfish. Got that one, give her 4 points on the afternoon. Lead 14 for the Spartans. Spearfish extending that defense, making it tough for the Raiders to get into their offensive set.
Yeah, over about the last three, 4 minutes, Raiders doing a much better job of moving the basketball against this zone, moving their bodies.
Tapped out of bounds by Dana with 15 on the shot clock.
And those passes, they're tough to make from way outside of an operating area. And that's why you want to stay spaced, but you want to be towing that three-point line as much as you can to shorten up those passes and also be a threat to shoot and score.
Peterson with 10 on the shot clock. Jones looking, 6 on the shot clock. Traveling, Griswold took an extra step after she took that pass. Turnover, Raiders. Porter in, Peterson out. Pressure in the backcourt applied by Stevens. But it melts away. Kochutin stumbled as she brought it forward. It was touched. Timeout. Spearfish. They want to save the possession there.
Yeah, heady timeout by Coach Johnson right there. Especially you just at the end of this third quarter right now after Rapid City Stevens tightens this ball game up again. And Spearfish has the opportunity right now. They're going to get an offensive possession coming out of this timeout. They're going to have to go back and defend, and then they're going to end up, hopefully, if all things go right, they're going to end up with another offensive possession. And you really just want to take advantage of every opportunity that you can get. Coming out, they'll have 26 on the shot clock.
16 turnovers for the Raiders, 0 for Spearfish. Well, I'll tell you about In Play with Craig Maddock. It features in-depth discussions about all things sports in South Dakota. Through these conversations, we learn about the players, programs, and legends who help shape the current sports landscape of the Mount Rushmore State. You can find the podcast on Apple, Google, Spotify, and wherever you get your podcasts. Be sure to leave us a 5-star review so that others are able to find it. In Play with Craig Maddock. All right, back to action here.
Looks like Stevens coming out of the timeout in a 2-3 zone alignment.
They got Porbear in the lineup to anchor that zone in the middle.
Yeah, they've pretty much been man-to-man the entire game up to this point. And there they find Kachutin off the flare.
And she hits the three. Give her 7 on the afternoon. J. Just everything going right for Spearfish today. They are playing great team basketball. Jones a three, that's on target. Her first points of the afternoon.
Both groups feeling good from the three-point line right now.
2 second difference between shot clock and game clock as we wind down quarter number three. See if they'll hold for the final opportunity. Shooting, takes a three, in and out. Porter with the rebound, has time with 10 seconds. Higgins, pull-up jumper, no rebound, Spearfish. Coach Shooting, let's see if she'll launch it from half court. Oh, hit the front of the rim. 47-33, Spearfish with the lead heading into the fourth quarter. Back in a moment. From the Curls Class AA Basketball Tournament, this is SDPB 3.
It's time to focus on you, a healthier you. It's time to get back to better health. Regular visits with a primary care provider at Sanford Health can lead to better overall health and wellness. It's time to get back to regular care. It's time for a healthier you and better health. It's time to see your doctor at Sanford Health.
Lucky for us, life is full of choices, big and small, just as it should be. They define us, make us who we are. And when it comes time for you to choose, a car, home, your next big adventure, or start a new business, Farmers Union Insurance has the variety of choices to make sure you have the perfect coverage to protect each perfect moment. Farmers Union Insurance.
And we are back, ready for the final stanza. Spearfish with the lead. They have the basketball to start.
We'll see who wants to finish their season off with a W here, Steve.
Spartans with the edge. Playing great ball. Bowman thought about the three. She's hit one already. Oh, dangerous pass. Bailed out. And there's a block on the shot attempt by Avery Kirk, who just checked into the game. But they're going to say Kirk lost it, never touched by a Raider, and it goes to Stevens.
And Bowman, who got a quick breather there at the end of the third, is back in the game. She's just been awesome today. 6 of 10 from the floor, 14 points, 4 rebounds, 2 assists.
Love with the three off the mark, but there's Porter with the rebound, and she'll get some free throws. Tough to stop her when she gets an offensive rebound that close to the basket.
Yeah, it's as a player, it's always weird to rebound air balls too. So you're hitting a body and you're expecting the ball to hit the rim and ricochet, and when it just comes right down to you, it just can make for an awkward situation.
Porter did not score at all in that third quarter. Spearfish outscored the Raiders 21-14 in that third period of play. She got them both, give her 14 on the afternoon. Raiders need some stops and to hit some shots. And that one was almost a turnover. It was touched by a Raider player.
Spearfish was a little fortunate there. They didn't look like they were too organized in their press break, and the shooting just lobs it over the top, and luckily it tips off a white defender.
Up traveling, no, a foul. Oh, I thought the player picked up the pivot foot. Hallie Peterson, that's her first. Remember, team fouls reset at every quarter break. Guth Miller gets the inbounds and the fresh shot clock. She's gonna go right to the lane, or to the paint, puts up a shot with the right hand, no good. Jones collects the rebound.
They tried running that same set that they did for Scharf in the first half, who finished the layup for Guth Miller and just couldn't quite convert.
Higgins with the ball, lobs it in, but there's good defense by Spearfish and Kochutin, who got the position to deny the pass.
17th turnover of the game right there for Stevens, and so far that's been the difference in the game.
Spearfish with just one turnover. Kirk Tried to maneuver inside. It went off the foot of a Raider out of bounds. Scharf and Dana in for Spearfish. Poor Bear Griswold in for the Raiders. 6.5 left. Quick three on the way. Front of the rim, no. And there's Porter with the rebound. Tied up in the backcourt by Donovan. Jump ball. Possession arrow, Raiders.
What do you know? Donovan around the basketball defensively. I feel like we've said that a time or 100 over this tournament. So impressed with her defensive effort.
Maddie is a junior, 5'5", and has been a defensive dynamo. Love with the ball, guarded by Kochutin. Griswold has hit 3 3-pointers today.
Yeah, they've Spearfish just man-to-man. They've been able to do a good job keeping in front. They're trying to isolate Porter, but Bowman's on that backside.
They have to launch it. That is a shot clock violation. No basket, no basket. Referee makes the call. It never touched the rim.
Yeah, Yeah, they got the right call. Took them a second, but apparently in officiating clinics, they tell you to hesitate and just make sure you're getting it right rather than blowing it right away. So the three stripes were implementing that philosophy.
Bowman with the ball, gonna move against Poor Bear. Puts it up short, but there's Donovan. Oh, she threw it up too quickly. Couldn't get set, but she tracks down the loose ball. Fresh shot clock for Spearfish.
It's going into a double high horns ball screen there. Trying to free Scharf.
Dana drives, and she's fouled on her approach to the bucket. And that's Griswold, her third personal. Second team foul on the Raiders. Spearfish one team foul as they'll play it in with the Spartans. Bowman, very active, drives the baseline, puts it up, and she'll get some free throws.
She's just such a versatile player, both offensively and defensively. She's shown the ability to knock down a couple threes thanks to one bank yesterday, one clean one today. She can also put it on the deck. She can post up. It does a little bit of everything for the Spearfish Spartans team.
This is the free throw there. That foul was on Poor Bear, her third. Porter's going to get, I thought Porter was going to get a break, but instead it's Love going to the bench as Higgins comes in. Bowman misses them both, and the rebound to Poor Bear.
Empty set. You like to convert at least one of those from the foul line. And Spearfish right now just still keeping the Raiders at distance, haven't cut it into single digits, but have the opportunity here on this possession.
Ball's on the floor, and Bowman gets a steal. Scharf in trouble, and she is gonna be fouled in the, nope, we have a timeout called by Spearfish before the foul. A timeout called by the Spartans before the foul was whistled. We'll keep it here as Spearfish spends one of their two remaining timeouts here. With 4:41 left to go, they did that to save the possession.
Yeah, Coach Dakota Johnson has been, she did that once in the first half as well. She's locked in on that, and really it just understands the value of taking care of the basketball and how important each possession is. And we've talked about this ad nauseum, but Stevens, 19 turnovers on the game, Spearfish only one. And you just can't understate the importance of taking care of the basketball, especially this time of the year if you're trying to have success.
Porter with 14 points leading the way for the Raiders. 14 points, 4 rebounds. Bowman, the top scorer for Spearfish. 9 points for Griswold, number two scorer, but Spearfish has a number of players contributing. Kochutin with 7, Guthmiller 5. Reiners with 5. Dana, their top scorer, only 2 points. And again, if you're a Spearfish fan and your top scorer has only got 2 points, but you're up by a dozen in the fourth quarter, you got to be feeling pretty good. You know it's a team effort.
No question. And they've been dynamite from the three-point land. 6 of 14 right now, 43%. Gotten to the foul line, 9 of 14 from there. 11 people so far have played for Spearfish. They've went really into their bench, and there's Dana over the top.
The breakout play works for Spearfish. Dana didn't miss the layup that time. She missed one earlier.
No.
Under 4.5 to go, the lead 14. And we're gonna have a whistle and a foul. Foul on the floor, I believe, as the ball trickled out of bounds. And that foul will be on Guthmiller, and that is her second. Timeout on the court, 4:21 left. Spearfish in control, back with more in a moment right here on SDPB3.
Bioethanol supplies more than just energy. It creates jobs in rural communities. It drives demand for local corn. It provides opportunities for family farms to thrive. To ensure agriculture plays a leading role in the efforts to decarbonize and transition energy, bioethanol remains at the forefront of a pursuit for a cleaner, brighter future for all Americans. Learn how at sdethanol.com.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
Raiders haven't scored in the last 3 minutes and 5 seconds. Spearfish on top of Rapid City Stevens, 49-35. Along with Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toon. Seventh place game here at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls, Class AA girls basketball. And the Raiders will play it in from the baseline. Poor Bear gets it back to Jones for the quick three. Yes.
They needed that one right there. Close this outcome, down 11 right now, coming up on the 4 minute mark.
Raiders need a few turnovers. Spearfish has been solid handling the ball today. They lob it over the top, Bowman, and it's gonna be a jump ball, possession arrow, Spartans.
Brittany Jones, great defensive positioning right there in the hole on the backside. They try to go over the top. Poor Bear was fronting Bowman, and Jones was right there to tie the ball up.
Swing it to the corner, and Dana, she'll bring it back out on top. Set things up with about 10 seconds left on the shot clock. Oh, there's a three on the way, short, and Poor Bear collects a rebound.
You feel pretty good if you're Spearfish. Whenever Scharf gets an open look, that one just came up a bit short.
Porter trying to muscle her way in, and Donovan took the ball away, but two free throws coming up. On the foul by Donovan, that's only her second, but in the act of shooting, third team foul.
Donovan was doing a nice job standing her ground there, taking that contact in the chest, but then brought that right hand down, making an easy call for the officials.
Porter makes the first free throw, 79% on the year. Guthmiller in, Donovan out for the Spartans.
I think this will be the first time she makes this, first time it's been in single digits for a while, Steve.
And she does, yeah, it has. Spearfish has had a double digit lead for a good chunk of the second half. They're up by seven, or check that, they were up, yeah, seven at the break. Down low, Scharf has it blocked. Opportunity for the Raiders. Still got 3 minutes to work with and change. Higgins rifles a pass to the corner. No shot there for Griswold. Jones, a three, yes.
Again, Brittany Jones. Third three of the game.
Kochutin cautiously forward is in trouble. And we have a push foul on the Raiders. And that's going to be on Porter, and that is her third. Porter, one of the more prolific scorers in Stevens history. Climbing up that chart. Has a chance to even maybe surpass Becky Hammond next year if she stays healthy and has a year she's capable of having. They can't afford to lose her to foul trouble as Guthmiller drives, counted in the foul.
Huge drive and finish there by Guthmiller. And we mentioned it earlier in the second half. She just lived. She's lived at the rim, lived in the paint this entire game. Has a chance for the old-fashioned three-point play.
And Porter just picked up her fourth personal foul. That is huge. The old-fashioned three-point play for Guthmiller. And just like that, the momentum that the Raiders had, that pendulum has swung back to Spearfish. Three-possession game, under 2.5 minutes to go. And a foul on Guthmiller on the perimeter, and that is her third personal. Fourth team foul. So we got free throws the rest of the way for both squads. Stevens already over the limit.
Defensively, and this is where you don't want to bail any of the offensive people out. Don't want them scoring points with the clock stopped. You just want to play good, solid, disciplined defense. Make them earn something tough.
Dana slipped there, recovered. Griswold the long three, it's going to be short. Rebound, good box out by Scharf.
It's a quality defensive possession when the Spartans needed it most.
Coach Chutin brings it up, now hands off to Dana. Oh, dangerous pass. Oh, but Scharf was able to save that one. And we're gonna have a foul, and I think it's gonna be on Griswold. That is number 4 on her. So Dana will go to the line. First time today for the junior, Josie Dana on the year, 78%. Big free throw. Spearfish could put this game away potentially at the free throw line. Love in, Griswold out for the Raiders.
And Griswold's given them some great minutes. Played 19 minutes in this game, 9 points, been active defensively.
Dana now with 6 points in the game. Spearfish keeping up a little bit of pressure. The clock is their friend at the moment. Pass to the corner, and Love has to pull it outside to Jones. Porter fakes the three. Into the paint, contact. There's Higgins with another rebound. Tries to put it up, and she does. And it looks like the Raiders want to call timeout with a minute 23 left.
Coach wanted the quick timeout there, set up his defensive full court pressure here. And as Dakota Johnson's gonna be talking about press break, talking about what they wanna do if they get the ball across half court here. And as the Raiders being down 9 here with only a minute 23 left, you gotta think about if they beat you in that full court, you gotta think about potentially if the right person has the ball in their hands, and this is where you want to kind of play some percentages if you know them and can. If the right person has it, you might contemplate taking an early foul, playing the odds.
See some of the action from earlier. That's Higgins. He's had a sensational tournament. And Bowman, what a big game today. Stat that has escaped my notice, Josie Dana, 6 assists on the afternoon. And I don't know if I've ever seen a team that has committed near 20 turnovers in 2 previous games come back in the third game and almost have a clean sheet. That is unprecedented.
Yeah, do you think the coaches were talking to him about that at all after?
I think so. I think every coach talks about turnovers, but yeah. Spearfish execution-wise today, they have been stellar. I mean, but to have a turnaround like that, and, you know, we still got a minute 23 left to go. I don't know if I've ever seen that in a state tournament before, where a team that has had that many problems. Well, there's a turnover.
Yeah,
I just jinxed them.
Yeah, we jinxed them. The announcer jinxed. Never fails. But yes, even anytime you're in single digits, you feel really good about how you executed and took care of the basketball.
Especially coming off of 2 games where you didn't execute well. But Credit to Spearfish for playing very good basketball today. Here's a three from Griswold, yes!
She's such a quick trigger, and she's been aggressive. Anytime she's got an ounce of daylight, that thing's been up.
Kochutin gets it into the front court. Now, with a minute to go, do you foul if you are the Raiders? Bowman in the paint, puts it on the floor, throws it up off the window, short. Jones fighting for the rebound, and we'll have a jump ball. The possession arrow favors the Raiders with 48.6 seconds left. Into the game, Sierra West, number 15 for the Spartans. She is a senior.
You would have liked to maybe see a little bit more time come off the clock, but Bowman had a point-blank opportunity in the paint, and so she went up and tried to finish it, just couldn't convert.
Griswold couldn't fire the shot, steps back, launches it off the front of the rim. But there's Love, but I think she lost it out of bounds. Trying to make a play there. Here comes Higgins into the game. Poor Bear will get a rest. 30.9 seconds left.
Coach Dannenbring wants him to face guard, try to make catches tough here. Said one trap, and then if they get it out, foul.
Leads only six. They'll lob it in. A couple players collide. Look out. Good sportsmanship. There's a player helps up an opposing player. And Porter has just fouled out of the game. A huge blow to the Raiders. Their top scorer leaves the game. Ends her, potentially her junior year, with 16 points. Well, she's out of the game. Her season is over, but got a feeling she'll be on an all-state team, no doubt.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the way she's performed throughout the year, and had a bit of a quieter first game on Thursday, and been really effective here yesterday and then yet again today.
That's a big free throw. That makes it 7 points. Shot clock is off. Kochutin with 9 in the game. And the lead is now 8 points. Griswold races up court. Raiders looking for a three, and that's the last thing Spearfish wanted to do, is commit a foul and stop the clock. Guthmiller got her fourth.
Guthmiller was trying to take away the three-point look by Finley Love and just got a little too over-aggressive, and the refs caught that body contact.
Free throw no good by Finley Love, a 92% free throw shooter on the season. Dana checks out of the game. Donovan, West, Bowman, Kochutin, Guthmiller on the court for Spearfish, and that one will fall. Now Love will check out. Schreiber in. Raiders with the full court press. See if Spearfish goes over the top. They do. West trying to track it down. She'll put it up and score. Sierra West, her first points on the weekend.
Second time that press break has worked. They screen across and then they just release against the face guard.
With 6.9 seconds left, we'll get some free throws. And I think Guthmiller, the senior, has just fouled out of her last game.
She knew she wanted the swan song there, Steve, so she decided to take one, and well-deserved with how Guthmiller was competing today.
Yeah, Guthmiller a fine game with 8 points, 3 assists, 3 rebounds. And that free throw no good by Griswold. So Spearfish gonna claim 7th place. Here this afternoon. Stick around, we'll have the awards handed out after the game. And Griswold makes the free throw. She's just a sophomore. That's 13 points for her.
Yeah, this Stevens team, we talked about it yesterday, only have one senior on the roster in Isabella Higgins, and then the rest are all juniors and underclassmen. So I suspect that we'll probably see this group back right here again next year.
Yep. That was a foul on Finley Love. That is her third. Checked out her second foul. And Addie Reiner's to the line. 5 points on the afternoon, make it six. She is a senior.
Yeah, and if you're a Spearfish, you just, yeah, you have to absolutely love how you finish this tournament and played really hard defensively, created 20 turnovers, were clean offensively. It's a great way for them to end their season.
Free throw no good. Poor Bear with the rebound, lobs ahead to Jones, but it's off her fingertips, out of bounds with 0.7 seconds left. Spearfish fans standing to celebrate as they will claim seventh place. 59-50, the final score. Congratulations to Spearfish as they will end their season with a 16-8 mark and seventh place here at the state AA girls basketball tournament. Bowman with 14 points, 4 rebounds, 4 assists, leading the way for a balanced Spartan attack. Porter, 16 points and 7 rebounds before fouling out the top scorer for Rapid City Stevens.
Yeah, really impressive by Spearfish, just the sheer number of contributors that they had offensively. And obviously, you'd mentioned it, Bowman led them with 14, but impressive contributions from their bench, especially.
Let's turn it over to Greg Thompson for the awards to be handed out.
Number 13, Jessa Griswold. Number 14, Everly Peterson. Number 20, Isabel Higgins. Number 21, Tamaya Poorbear. Number 23, Hallie Peterson. Number 24, Lexi Portlock. Number 25, Mackenzie Schreiber. Number 32, Kinsey Dillavu. Number 42, Olivia Miller. Managers, Haley Eisenbraun, Gabby Leash, Faith Neal. Assistant coaches, Tanner Waggy, Quintrell Porter, Gerald Johnson, and Seth Keane. And accepting the eighth place trophy, head coach Adam Dannenbring. Ladies and gentlemen, your Stevens Raider. And now let's present the awards to the Spartans of Spearfish in seventh place. Number 1, Sophie Guthmiller. Number 3, Adeline Bowman. Number 5, Maddie Donovan. Number 10, Josie Dana. Number 11, Avery Kirk. Number 15, Sierra West. Number 12, Briley Grubb. Number 20, Addie Reiners. Number 21, Tiersen Grubb. Number 23, Kate Sharp. Number 24, Callie Reiners. Number 30, Mariah Bohm. Number 32, Michael Chutin. Number 33, Lenny Ewing. Managers, Chloe Pesek and Lucy Tennant. Assistant coaches, Jamie Bentley, Jamie Santer, Remy Wenches, and head coach for the Spartans of Spearfish, Dakota Johnson. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together again for the Raiders of Stevens and the Spartans of Spearfish.
Congratulations to Spearfish. They claim seventh place at the girls' AA basketball tournament. Back in a moment with more right here on SDPB3.
We hope you're a fan of stories about heroes, because we'd like you to meet a few of ours. These folks keep our communities moving forward. They're dedicated to being here for you, navigating change, keeping you secure, and offering a helping hand to those who need it. Heroes come from many walks. Ours are here to walk with you. Go with trust. Go with people. Go with Dakota Bank.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
We all need insurance to protect our health, our homes, our belongings, and our businesses. But coverage is just the beginning. You also need the support of professionals who stand by your side to protect what's important to you. Fisher Rounds and Associates combines the coverage you want with the commitment you need. Fisher Rounds and Associates, at your service, at your side.
I was looking for something that was gonna be close to home.
Southeast Tech has definitely helped me. I'm actually doing something that I enjoy.
This is the right place to be.
Get your degree, get to work at Southeast Tech.
Beginning April 6th, watch SDPB Saturday evenings for a new lineup of shows. Start the night laughing with Keeping Up Appearances at 5, 4 Mountain. Then, the drama unfolds with back-to-back episodes of Midsummer Murders. Tag along with private investigator Alexa Cross in My Life is Murder at 7, 6 Mountain, followed by the fan favorites Doc Martin and Father Brown. Plus, Sister Boniface joins us on Sunday evenings at 6, 5 Mountain.
Spearfish wins 59-50 over Rapid City Stevens. Let's check out the highlights from the second half, and Spearfish was just executing well.
Yeah, there's Bowman, who obviously had a big night with 14 with the game.
There you see Higgins on the drive. She had a solid tournament. Just couldn't get going offensively today, but Bowman inside dominated, not only offensively, but defensively.
Yeah, she was all over the court, a huge reason why the game ended up the way it did.
As you see the run out there, that was Dana, who missed the layup earlier. Three-pointers kept Stevens in this contest in the fourth quarter.
Yeah, 8 of 16 overall for Stevens. Spearfish 6 of 15 from 3. They were both feeling good from out there.
But in the end, too much Spearfish as Sierra West gets a closing bucket. Check out the team stats here. Turnovers, the key stat. just 2 for Spearfish, 21 for the Raiders. Field goals, the advantage to Spearfish. Three-pointers, almost a wash. Rebounding, a big plus for the Raiders, but Spearfish took care of the basketball as well as you're ever going to see in a state tournament.
Yeah, you're just not going to lose many games, if ever, only turning the ball over 2 times and just getting the amount of opportunities and possessions that they did.
You know, while we got a moment here, I want to talk about people who inspire people without talking about those who inspire our kids. You know, we've got to talk about the coaches. Ruth Dreamer took a job this season with the Ulrichs boys basketball team, along with getting her feet wet in a new home. She's also helping lay the foundation of new traditions with that Tiger squad.
Basketball is life to me. I grew up watching it before I actually got to play the game. So I think that's where, like, the interest and the love for it grew, is I just got to be around it.
Ruth Dreamer has had a strong love for basketball her entire life. This year, she took a new job as the boys basketball coach for Ulrichs High School.
This number calls me and they're like, hey, are you coaching anywhere? And I'm like, no. And they're like, well, we need a coach. I'm like, where at? And they're like, Ulrichs boys varsity. I'm like, really? And they're like, yeah, if you're down. I'm like, yeah, sure, let me come in. You know, did the interview the next day, got hired. And it was definitely a challenge, because like I said, I did never think I would. But it's exciting and it's fun. I really, really like it, especially with this group of boys. They're really eager to learn. So it's just been really, really an amazing experience.
Ruth grew up in Pine Ridge, where she became a standout player for the Lady Thorpes.
I actually had 1,800 points in my high school career. So the first thought people asked me was, well, when did I start playing in high school? And they actually asked me as a 7th grader to play, but I never wanted to. I always thought I was way too small. So I wanted to stay in middle school until I graduated 8th grade. But back then I played the first 2 quarters for my freshman team. So they're like, okay, we're going to save you for JV. So then I played 2 quarters on JV. And they're like, okay, we're going to save you for varsity. So I played 2 quarters on varsity, and then from that day on, I never played freshman or JV again. I became a starter for varsity for the rest of my career.
Ruth is focused on creating something special at her new home.
I guess it just shifted more or less to the program that I want to build here.
As long as you keep dribbling, he's going to get out of the way because you're bigger, but when you extend that arm, then it's offensive.
You know, and keep like Ulrichs is a great school. They have Wilding, they have Woods. We're actually getting a new weight room built. Like I said, this gym's only 2 years old, this whole school actually. So it's just exciting, because I think that's where like my mindset shifted, where I'm not like worried about my position as much as I am about the recreation of this school, like the foundation of it, you know? Like I really, really want to start and end my career here. Like this is the program I want to build.
It's a great opportunity. She pushes me to be the best that I can, and every day at practice. She doesn't force anything on me, and it just helps me love the game even more. You know, she just pushes me to be a better person every day, and I appreciate her for that. My first thought when I heard that a female coach was going to be our coach was I thought she wasn't going to be able to coach us because she's a girl and this is a man's sport. But after the first day of practice, she showed me that she has a lot more to offer than other coaches in the past year, and she knows a lot more than boys, you know, I could tell you that. She's a very vocal coach, but if you do something wrong, she ain't going to get on your butt about it and tell you that you're doing something wrong. She's going to teach you to stop doing that and make it a good habit rather than a bad habit. She taught me to eat right, healthy, treat your body just as, you know, you would. Don't put toxic things in it, like smoking, drinking, alcohol, and that stuff, you know.
Along with helping players be successful on and off the court, Ruth hopes she can also be a role model for future females in the state.
Honestly, I would say just, you know, stick with your goals and dreams. You know, like I said, I didn't think I'd be coaching a boys team, but I love it. It's exciting. It's a new challenge, and I'm always up for a new challenge. But, you know, just take your time and be patient, you know, because I almost was like I said, I was just going to sit back and not coach anywhere, you know, and I answered that call or whatever. But just, I would just say take your time and just stay focused, because you never know when your opportunity is going to present itself.
SDPB recently produced a program entitled Tales from the Hardwood, which features Ruth's story and others. Go to sdpb.org/basketball and watch Tales from the Hardwood today. Back in a moment, we'll set up the fifth place game after this timeout here on SDPB 3.
Our teams are committed to improving quality of life in our communities. Whether we're planning construction concepts, building a new downtown development, bringing new businesses to our communities, or maintaining your apartment home. We believe everyone deserves a well-built and well-managed place to live and work. This is Lloyd.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great. Like 15 pizzas. Yo! Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
Oh my goodness.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation. So we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
Welcome back to the Pentagon in Sioux Falls. Heritage Court, the site for the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament. Along with Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toom, getting you ready for the Consolation Championship. Mitchell taking on Pierre, and it is Mitchell coming in as the number two seed in this tournament, number two in the final poll, but they stumbled the first day, and now they find themselves playing arch rival Pierre for fifth place. As you see, they are 20-3 coming into today. Some big wins during the regular season, including a win at Pierre. And I was talking to some of the Pierre people about that. For Mitchell, they won that game, but there was a tale of two halves, 32-18, then 31-18. That was the scores that flip-flopped in each half. And it was Pierre, or Mitchell rather, getting the win. That was back on February the 16th. Van Overshield, Stabner, Wyke, Seamson, Meyrink, that's the starting lineup. Stabner has scored 44 points in this tournament so far. She's been dynamite.
Absolutely dynamite. And a big thing for Mitchell, it's the reason they had success yesterday. They had that third head of that monster that Van Overshield ended up going for double figures versus on Thursday night versus Harrisburg. Where Stabner and Seamson were responsible for a lot of their scoring, couldn't get much else going.
Yep, as Van Overshield shut out the first day, had 11 yesterday, and that was a big X factor in their result. And Stabner, in addition to scoring, she also had 17 rebounds yesterday as well. She is a dynamite player, sure to be an all-stater. We'll take a break and come back and meet the Pierre Governors. More from the AA Girls Basketball Tournament right here on SDPB3.
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actegra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actegra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do, and that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
It's time to focus on you, a healthier you. It's time to get back to better health. Regular visits with a primary care provider at Sanford Health can lead to better overall health and wellness. It's time to get back to regular care. It's time for a healthier you and better health. It's time to see your doctor at Sanford Health.
Established in 1986, the Great Plains Tribal Leaders Health Board represents 18 tribal communities located in South Dakota, North Dakota, Nebraska, and Iowa. Our vision is that all tribal nations, communities, and citizens achieve optimal wellness through the embrace of traditional cultural values and innovative and holistic healing practices, strengthened by tribal sovereignty. For more information on our grant programs, health services, and career opportunities, visit our website at greatplainstribalhealth.org.
The way humans make sense of the world is through stories.
We've got to go ahead and start training to go to Mars.
And lift off.
We pay tribute to all who serve and who have served.
Civilization is precious. Life is precious.
Artists here are making a difference.
I'm trying to seek redemption.
Welcome back. Getting ready for the fifth place game between Mitchell and Pierre, ESD rivals. Very familiar with each other. This is a grudge match. The Pierre TF Riggs Governors, headed up by Kirk Bebout, 15-6 coming into tournament play. They had a rally that fell short against Jefferson. Cold shooting start. Came close, but just couldn't quite rally. And then yesterday, they had a much better game against Rapid City Stevens. As you see, their wins on the year, including against Spearfish and Jefferson, knocked off Huron in the Sodak 16. Had a big win yesterday, 52-45, hard-fought win over Stevens. That leads them into today. The Pierre Governors have kind of a three-headed monster. Dupree, Terwilliger, Barry, their main scorers. Gracelyn Taylor, defensive specialist. Elise Christofferson, stalwart defender.
Yeah, Dupree and Terwilliger had big nights yesterday. Dupree finishing with 20 points, Terwilliger with 21 points. And really the difference in their two games between Thursday and Friday, as you mentioned, field goal percentage. Only 27% against Sioux Falls Jefferson, 44% yesterday.
Mitchell, 5 championships in their resume, 29 appearances, 22 appearances for Pierre. The last title for Mitchell came back in 2012. I believe Mason Miller was on that team, if I remember correctly. And they finished runner-up in 2014 to the Mitchell Colonels. For Pierre, to a runner-up in last year, 2023. They finished runner-up in 2007, 2008. 97, they were runner-up in 1991 AA champs. We are just moments away from the introduction of the starting lineups for this fifth place game. Green and white, black and gold, those are the colors you're going to see in the stands here today and on the court as well. ESD rivals battle for the consolation championship here at the girls AA basketball tournament. We'll turn it over to our public address announcer, handling the duties as always, Mr. Greg Thompson.
Good afternoon, basketball fans. The South Dakota High School Activities Association welcomes you to this session of the State Girls High School Basketball Tournament. This tournament is being conducted under the guidance and regulation of the South Dakota High School Activities Association for the enjoyment and benefit of high school students. Good sportsmanship is essential for the success of these programs. We hope you enjoy the game and support your athletes in a positive and sportsmanlike manner. This game features the Colonels of Mitchell and the Governors of Pierre. And now let's meet today's starters in alternate fashion. For the Colonels, at guard, a 5'5 junior, number 12, Lauren Van Overshield. For the Governors, at guard, a 5'8 senior, number 3, Elise Christofferson. For the Colonels, at forward, a 5'9 senior, number 14, Sawyer Stabner. for the Governors at guard, a 5'6" junior number 10, Lennox Dupree. For the Colonels at guard, a 5'6" junior number 23, Carson White. For the Governors at guard, a 5'8" senior number 13, Ryan Berry. For the Colonels at guard, a 5'8" sophomore, number 32, Addie Simpson. For the Governors at forward, a 5'11" senior number 15, Reese Terwilliger. And for the Colonels at forward, a 5'10" senior number 42, Allison Meyering. For the Governors at guard, a 5'6" junior number 20, Gracelyn Taylor. The Colonels are led by Dave Brooks, assistant coaches Mackenzie Mertens, Christina Simpson, and Wes Morgan. The Governors are led by Kirk Bebout, assistant coaches Terry Becker, Carice Blanchette, and Jeff Sheckleway. Your officials for this game, Bo Garcia, Matt Kemp, and Kim Zimmerman.
Hit the lights. We're ready for a consolation championship game. Stabner, Terwilliger, or check that. Gonna be Barry in the center circle, and the tip controlled by Mitchell. They're in the gold uniforms, the black numbers and letters. Pierre in the home white, the green number and letters.
Yeah, we'll probably see primarily man-to-man defense from both groups. Their Pierre starts off in it.
And the shot missed by Van Overshield. Here's Taylor on the run, doesn't have a shot. And the Governors will set up in their offense. Dupree, guarded by White, lost the handle. There's a pileup and a jump ball possession arrow, Pierre.
Good hustle by Addie Simpson, immediately getting on the floor. Sometimes it takes a minute or two to get in the game, and there she is, 33 seconds flying on there.
And she gets the steal. Nice defensive play. The left-hander on the runout will score. Mitchell has a plethora of left-handed shooters on their team, and Simsa almost got a steal there. And Stabner didn't hear the whistle. And she has a smile on her face. She's that locked in.
Yeah. She's that type of competitor. Yeah, we've said it quite a bit over this tournament that she sets the tone, and Mitchell just being incredibly active defensively right now. It's causing peer problems here early on.
Mitchell one by one during the regular season. Taylor three, bounces high, a rebound, Simpson. Van Overshield, the drive, nothing there. Dupree ties her up along the baseline, puts up a shot, and there's Dupree with the rebound. Dupree, one of those left-handers out there. Mitchell has a bunch.
Terwilliger had a bit of a mismatch there, had White on her for a second, then they switch back.
Oh, in and out for Barry on the three. It was halfway down and bounced out.
Two contrasting styles in the half court offensively, whereas Mitchell's going to set a lot of off-ball screens, as we've mentioned before, whereas Pierre, it's going to be more on-ball screen action.
Christofferson draws the defensive assignment of Staber. Seems like Christofferson always has the main player for other teams. That's the one she's going to be guarding in the man-to-man. 8 seconds left, Stabner.
It's a good dig down by Dupree there.
Simpson all the way, lost the handle, out of bounds. It goes to the Governors. Kirsch into the game. Brianna Kirsch, number 44, and also number 33, Mackenzie Peterson, into the game for Mitchell. That's their usual substitution pattern.
The Colonels are going to be extended full court, aggressive man-to-man. There, Simpson comes up with another steal.
And finishes with the left hand again. Simpson paying cashing in on those turnovers. And now Christofferson lobs it ahead to Dupree on the move. Bumped and a foul coming in. Two free throws for Dupree.
Yeah, and that's the one thing when you're going to pick up full like Mitchell does a lot of the time. It can, if you're able to throw over the top or create some runouts, it's going to be able to create some good transition opportunities for you. But the key is make sure that you're taking care of the basketball in order to get those opportunities.
Dupree, a junior, granddaughter of legend Terry Dupree, who ended up being drafted by the Detroit Pistons. And she makes two free throws. Pressure broken. Peterson having a tough time handling it. Gets it back from Seamson. Stabner for three. In and out. The rebound. Twilliger had it, lost it, but got it back outside to Dupree.
Stabner just off that same set action where she gets that foul flare. She's knocked down a few different threes off that. She winds up getting herself open about every time they execute that. There's Terwilliger with the deep touch, just doesn't fall.
Now, Terwilliger tough in the paint because she can finish at the rim with either hand. Weick, a three, yes. Seven-two, Mitchell on top early on. Oh, Dupree just lost it. And we are going to have a jump ball. Timeout on the court, 4:27 left to go here in the first quarter. It's 7-2 in favor of Mitchell. Back in a moment right here on SDPB3.
Dreamer, doer, difference maker. These are just a few things we look for when growing our team at Dakota Bank. Those with empathy and a commitment to doing what's right build their careers with us. If you're about relationships and helping others, Dakota Bank is calling. Will you answer? Go with integrity. Go with teamwork. Go with Dakota Bank.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Welcome back to the Pentagon in Sioux Falls. Fifth place game between Pierre and Mitchell. And it is Mitchell on top 7-2, along with Nate Kading. I'm Steve Toom. Mitchell plays it in the backcourt, faces some pressure, but Van Overshield brings it up.
Three early turnovers thus far for Pierre, and it's created a lot of offense so far for Mitchell, and they need to make sure that they're taking care of the basketball.
Van Overshield on the drive, gets to the corner and Kirsch, no shot for her, goes cross court. Back to Van Overshield, gets around Dupree, lobs it up off the window and it's good.
That was a great seal by Kirsch there. She was working her post position inside. Defender was playing high side, she kept her feet moving. Oh,
and
there's
another
Van
steal.
Overshield.
And she'll score again. Barry having some problems bringing the ball up the court. And she's had her pocket picked a couple of times.
Yeah, they may need to look at setting what I refer to as just a quick crackback ball screen in the full court to release that pressure.
Christofferson steps back with one dribble. Finds Dupree, here's the lob to Williger. Gets it back to Dupree, players hit the deck. Weak side Taylor had a block foul.
And immediately when they got the touch into Terwilliger there was three bodies around her. Mitchell knows that when she gets a touch here and there, there's gonna be a tension coming her way, and There she made a good read, kicked it right back out, and that's what she's going to have to do.
Foul on Van Overshield, her first. Taylor at the line, got it. On the years, believe it or not, just a 17% free throw shooter.
Yeah, so far 3 points for Pierre, all coming from the foul line with Dupree hitting two and Taylor hitting the first.
Missed that one, Stabner a rebound. Myring handles, now to Stabner, guarded by Christofferson. She wears that big brace on that left knee. Van Overshield has to hand it off to Stabner.
Yeah, and when things break down for Mitchell, 14, Sawyer Stabner is the one to watch.
Five on the shot clock, Van Overshield. Here's a long shot, Myrink, no, and Christofferson the rebound.
Gritty defensive possession there by Pierre.
Yeah, Myrink is not the player that Mitchell probably wants shooting three-pointers. She had to launch it. She almost made it. That was a good look. Here's Dupree from the corner. Yes, on the three.
Continues her hot streak from yesterday. Hit a couple of them from outside. 6 of 8 yesterday from the free throw line. 2 of 5 from three. Finished with 20. Off to a quick start.
Yeah, Dupree, 16 points the first day, 20 yesterday. Stabner. Oh, there's a near interception. Yep, Barry does get the turnover.
Got Dupree running the right wing. Oh, they reverse it around.
Christofferson knocks down a three. Pierre trying to get a turnover in the backcourt. It stays with Mitchell.
The Governor's immediately on the make. They're setting up their 1-2, 1-1 full court press.
They'll go up court to Myrink. Gets it back to Stabner. He just seems to be able to do everything. Peterson with the ball. Stabner. Kicks it to the outside. Wyke throws it into the backcourt, and this is going to be over and back.
Early on in the possession, quality ball movement by Mitchell there. She had a good drive, was looking for the kick, just a little bit outstretched on that pass. Passing the basketball, such an underrated skill to put it on your teammates' hands in their shooting pockets so they're able to catch, shoot, catch and rip an attack, make a quick decision with the ball.
Williger handled the ball there momentarily. She's had a dynamite tournament. 16-10 and 21-7 yesterday. Foul on the play, it's on Mitchell.
And the Colonels are just not gonna allow 15, Reese Twilliger, any type of space when she catches the basketball.
Seamson got the foul, her first. Third team foul. Barry got open, uses the window nicely.
Yes, they got that yesterday one time. Great set action, hit Barry, faked the handoff to the inbounder, turned baseline and with the finish.
Tied at 11. Under a minute to go. And we're gonna have a foul on Barry out on the perimeter. That's the first foul against Pierre.
9-0 run so far for Pierre after getting in an early drought.
Now Mitchell has a scoring drought of 3 minutes, 11 seconds and counting. And that was the tail in this first game. Both teams win on runs. Mitchell prevailed by a point. Here's a shot up. It misses the mark. But there's Wyke with the weak side rebound. Here's a three. No good. Still didn't hit the rim, but shot clock is off as Pierre brings it the other way. Look out, player out of control, out of bounds. As that was Grace Richter hitting the deck. She checks in number 23 a moment ago.
Yeah, Richter plays 100 miles an hour on both sides of the ball. There, Dupree gets a deflection, stays with Mitchell.
15 seconds left. He'll get it into Stabner. Now back to Seamson. Plenty of time for Mitchell to set up a final opportunity. Stabner lost the handle out of bounds with 3 seconds left.
They found the person that you want the basketball in. Just a little mishandle by Stabner.
They throw the half court, but it's taken away and over and back. Just the momentum there by Peterson. She made a nice play, but is that a bad spot?
We got some hectic action here to end the first quarter.
0.8 seconds, here we go. Gotta be quick. It's tapped away, and that's a play by Peterson. We'll end the first half tied at 11. Back with more from the Consolation Championship here at the Girls AA Basketball Tournament. You're watching SDPB 3.
You've worked hard to build your business, your reputation, your success. Your financial partner should be committed to digging in to drive your vision forward. For 130 years, we've stood by South Dakotans. We've been there, we'll be there. Convenient, connected, committed. Bank West, member FDIC.
A community is more than buildings. It's where you live, where you work. Community is being there for each other. Lending a hand when your neighbors are in need. Community is all of us coming together for a greater purpose. This is community. This is Lloyd.
And we are back here at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls. Quarter number two underway. We're tied at 11. And we're going to have a whistle and, I believe, kick ball.
Neither team going to be able to match the Spearfish Spartans for taking care of the basketball. Early 6 turnovers for Pierre. Mitchell, 5.
Jump ball, possession arrow, Mitchell. I don't know what the record is for fewest turnovers at a state tournament. It might be 0 or 1, I don't know, but it's hard to get better than 2.
Yeah, that was something. There's Seamson.
Wow.
Third lefty finish early so far for Addie Seamson.
She has 6 points, and Mitchell reclaims the lead. Berry with the drive. Here's to Williger, throwing it outside to Christofferson. Misses the three. And there's Wyke with the rebound.
The right basketball play by Terwilliger. Draws attention. Clean look for the Governors.
And over shield. And a nice play along the sideline there, guarded by Dupree. Can't make anything happen. She'll circle up.
Dupree just hounding the basketball.
There's the open shooter. It's Seamson, misses on the three. And that's Terwilliger chasing down that rebound. Oh, they got Dupree open. She'll have to maneuver, throw it outside. Berry stops, won't fire the three. And boy, Pierre was just a heartbeat late from getting a fast break opportunity.
Yeah, you would have liked to see Dupree try to go up and finish that thing on the right side of the basket. She's a lefty who's probably a little more comfortable slicing to that dominant hand. And then by that time, Mitchell did a good job of sprinting back and matching up.
Fouls on Stabner, her first, team's first here in the second quarter. Taylor with the inbounds. Outside to Dupree, now to Williger in the paint. Here comes that double team. Dupree through traffic, lost the handle. Mitchell with the ball.
Ooh, Van Overshield was thinking about it.
Meyerink throws it up, no good. And Dupree collects the rebound. And a quick timeout has been called by Pierre. Kurt Bebout wants to talk things over. A 30-second timeout.
A lot of the ball screen action right now for Pierre, which they get into a ton. Mitchell's just doing a good job of sliding underneath the guards for Pierre. Forces them or gives them the opportunity not to have to switch a guard onto Terwilliger, because that's a mismatch and one that is not going to be good for the Colonels.
Don't forget, you can follow us all season long on your mobile device, SDPB Sports. Check us out on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, and be sure to check out all our action and award photos by searching for SDPB on Flickr. Tell us where you're watching us from, read some of our great stories, and watch some of our videos that feature the teams, the players, and the coaches here in South Dakota. Hashtag SDHoops24 at SDPB Sports. Of course, we handed out some awards earlier today. Spearfish claiming seventh place here. They beat arch rival Rapid City Stevens 59-50. That was for seventh place. This is for the fifth place game, and there's another turnover for Pierre. See if Mitchell can capitalize. Pierre's been their own worst enemy today so far.
Yeah, Coach Bebout over there coming out of a timeout. It's just, he's probably not loving that execution.
That's what gives coaches ulcers and gray hairs.
You got that right.
And there's a turnover for Mitchell.
Yeah, and Pierre, Mitchell's so good in the half court defensively that you want to try to push just like they were trying to do. And yeah, get that early offense. If you can attack against an unset defense, your field goal percentage is going to drastically grow. It's going to grow incrementally if you're able to do that. And there you see it from the Governors.
Ryan Berry hitting that last shot. Here's Peterson. No. Rebound Berry. Ryan Berry heading off to Shadron to play basketball. Was a kicker on the football team this year for Pierre. Also, I believe Ryan plays soccer as well, and Dupree misfires on the three. And there's Peterson with the rebound.
Dupree was extended out a ways, but the way she can shoot it and the confidence she plays with, fired it up.
Weick, and she is going to be fouled. Blocking foul, that will be against Pierre, and that will be on Dupree. Timeout on the court with 4:44 left to go here in quarter number two. We're tied up at 13 between Mitchell and Pierre. Back in a moment on SDPB3.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
There is a new world out there, revealing itself in unpredictable ways. A world that demands more from the land and those who grow, farm, and build on it. This new world calls for the ingenuity to get more out of it while preserving as much as we can. After all, to stay ahead of tomorrow, we need to be equipped for it today.
Dakota Plains New Holland dealers proudly support high school athletics.
Even up here between Pierre and Mitchell at the Consolation Championship for the girls' Class AA basketball tournament. Tied up at 13, along with Nate Kading. I'm Steve Toome. Great to have you here this afternoon. Final day of the girls' basketball season. And here at AA, we've already handed out a seventh-place trophy to Spearfish. These teams battling for fifth place.
Both coaches have to like the aggressiveness that their teams are playing with on the defensive end. It's just their execution and getting quality shots up on the offensive end that I'm sure is being talked about a lot. And there, Ryan Berry just picks Seamson's pocket.
Returning the favor, and she'll score. Play there by Berry, and now more problems for Mitchell at half court. A jump ball, possession arrow, Pierre.
Gracelyn Taylor's been one. She's a scrappy defender. She's made plays on that side of the floor the last 3 days. And the ability to handle pressure as a ball handler is just, it's so important when you're getting full court pressed and they're extended out on you in the half court.
Barry drives, gets close, had a block, but a foul as Barry hit the deck hard.
Yeah, Van Overshield tried to fill over a little late and make a play on the ball. And that's where you want to be early to that help, especially from that baseline fill. You want to try to meet them outside the lane. That way you can just stop them with your chest, even look to take a charge, and you're not jumping out, having to foul them.
Barry at the line for two free throws on the year, 76%. She averages nearly 12, but has been held in check in the first two games, scoring 5 points, 4 points respectively. Wyke in, Van Overshield out. Van Overshield with two personal fouls.
Yeah, your team just becomes so much more potent when you can find that third weapon. We talked about it with Mitchell, and it's no different from Pierre. You kind of know what you're going to get from Dupree and Terwilliger to a certain extent, and having Barry be somebody that can produce for him is huge for him.
Pass tip, Myring went out to get it. Myring going to go to Wesleyan for golf and basketball, and there's Stabner, her first points.
And Pierre's trying to do whatever they can to keep the ball out of 14's hands, and there's Stabner with the heady back cut.
Stabner's such a high-quality athlete, very smart athlete as well, as Terwilliger just fell down and lost the handle. Now here's Stabner with the pass. Wyke saves it, but right to Barry. Turnover for Mitchell after the turnover by Pierre.
You can see Mitchell just content, and there they switch that one a little bit bigger on big.
Terwilliger, oh, was fouled, gets two free throws, that shot just a little bit short of the mark. And that's a foul on Stabner, and that's her second personal foul. With 3:02 left to go until halftime, Terwilliger yet to score.
It's great vision by Christofferson there. Catches it off the ball reversal. First thing she looked at is probably the rim. Second thing was that quick buddy-buddy pass right to Terwilliger rolling to the rim.
Terwilliger signed to play basketball School of Mines. Of course, Stabner signed to play basketball Black Hill State. Those two will be seeing each other a lot over the next few years, and that will be intense rivalry basketball. I speak from firsthand experience as a Yellow Jacket alum, and a proud Yellow Jacket alum, I might add.
Yeah, they'll be seeing plenty of one another. And there's Wyke with the open look.
And there's a battle for the rebound. There's a pileup on the floor. Who's got it? Both teams. Boy, they're still fighting. I'm always saying that play, is it a jump ball or first down? Because they battle, and they are. You play till the echo of the whistle.
Being the first to the floor hasn't been an issue for any of the teams in this tournament, and it's no wonder that the eight that are here with us today are.
Richter just got run over. Boy, it is getting physical out there as Stabner hits the bounce pass to Seamson, and she drove in, and an offensive foul as she stuck out that elbow. See the Pierre fans celebrating.
Yeah, actually, that's one of those ones you don't probably mind as a coach. Addie Seamson's going aggressively, trying to get into the body, create space into the finish, and Terwilliger did a nice job of standing in and taking it.
Here's the pass. Terwilliger couldn't handle it. She was open under the basket, could have had a layup, but it slipped through her fingers. We talk about this being an ESD grudge match, and so far it has lived up to that. Very physical basketball. Doesn't matter if it's the boys or the girls playing. When these two schools get together, you know it's going to be intense. Seamson, yes.
Both teams are going to extend out in the full court, but they're both tough and physical, even in the half court. Sitting down. Some teams that press a lot will be a little looser, a little bit less resistance in the half court, but not either one of these groups.
Terwilliger missed the shot. Rebound to Pierre. And the foul. Terwilliger, a little frustration there. She collects only her first personal foul. Boy, she has not had many clean looks. That time she did and just missed the shot. Here's Peterson with the ball, hounded by Richter.
And as you can see by Christofferson's alignment there, they're essentially face guarding Sawyer Stabner and trying to keep the ball out of her hands whenever possible.
Mitchell getting opportunity after opportunity. And there's Christofferson pulling away the basketball. That brings the Pierre fans to their feet.
Got numbers up ahead.
Richter's got to get it across the timeline, just barely does. And now a foul, and that is going to be on, believe, Carson Weick, as players hitting the deck all over the place.
Richter,
for Weick, that's her first.
Yeah, and she'll be going to the line as it's the fifth foul. Richter, we mentioned it, 100% at all the time. She's a speedster out on the court as well. She can move with the ball.
Defensive player coming off the bench, averages 2 points, 1.5 rebounds a game, but she plays that tough nose defense on the perimeter. She is into the scoring column. She had 4 points yesterday, did not score on Thursday. Richter, a junior at 5'7". Got them both. Not bad for the 40% free throw shooter. She'll get a nice big hand as Richter is out. Taylor in for Pierre. Pierre maybe goes two players deep. Mitchell will bring more players off the bench. And in day three, that's important, especially in an intense game like this.
Yeah, and Graves for Mitchell hasn't gotten a ton of run so far in the tournament, but she is today, as you mentioned, third game in 3 days. Got to try to keep your players as fresh as you can.
That's going to be a foul on Taylor, and that is her first. Team foul number three with 1:04 left to go until halftime.
Yeah, and Pierre mixing in a little bit of a half-court zone here, and there Stabner does a great job of seeing opposite.
Meyrink with the offensive rebound. Stabner lines up a three. That's too long, and Barry pulls away the rebound. Outlet to Taylor. She'll give way to Christofferson. They'll swing it around to Dupree.
Get an early one up here. You're going to get the ball back. A little two-for-one situation.
Well, they let that go by the boards.
Yeah.
Running their offense. Taylor pulls it back outside. Oh, lost the handle, but got it back. Christofferson in the paint, misses it off the window. Shot clock is off. Stabner saw it, and she'll slow it down with the left-handed dribble.
High ball screen for her.
Drive to the baseline, and traveling the call. A costly turnover for Mitchell. 12.7 seconds left. The length of the floor to go for Pierre. They've got plenty of time. We're up by one. Barry takes it away from Weick. Oh, she almost lost it. And we're going to have a foul. And that's going to be, I believe, on Peterson. And it is her first. But that means free throws for Ryan Barry.
Yeah, Peterson trying to make the hustle play there. Those are unfortunate ones where she's playing with great effort, getting on the floor, just so happens to get into the legs and an easy call for the stripes.
Free throw no good for Ryan Barry. She also plays pickleball as well.
All around athlete.
Yep.
Soccer, basketball, pickleball.
Football. As a kicker.
Here I was thinking pickleball was an old person sport for you and I, Steve.
5 seconds left. Meyrink lost it to Barry. They've got a chance. She's going to launch it. It's blocked by Meyrink. And a very hard-fought, competitive first half of basketball sees Pierre fall behind early, but they rally. They lead 20-18 at the break. Back with more from the girls' AA basketball tournament in a moment right here on SDPB3.
As much as you have accomplished, there are times you'd rather not go it alone. While you determine what direction you go, we're here to help along the way. So go. Go with community. Go with neighbors. Go with understanding. Go with support.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
It's time to focus on you, a healthier you. It's time to get back to better health. Regular visits with a primary care provider at Sanford Health can lead to better overall health and wellness. It's time to get back to regular care. It's time for a healthier you and better health. It's time to see your doctor at Sanford Health.
Anthem Oats in Frederick is a proud community partner and supports high school activities in South Dakota. The Sumptions have been stewards of the soil since 1882. From the family farm right to your pantry. AnthemOats.com.
Are you nervous?
A little.
And action!
Bright things ahead, darling. Brightness and joy.
I've got plans.
Everything feels better after a cup of tea.
No, Harkin.
I just want to be right here in this moment with you.
You're going to be a bigger star than ever.
This is good news for all of us.
Best episode ever.
Pierre on top of Mitchell here at the break for fifth place at the girls double A basketball tournament. Let's check out the highlights from that first half of play as Mitchell got off to a big start right away, as it was Seamson with a couple of steals and some left-handed layups, and then White hits that three-pointer. It seemed like everything was going right for the black and gold as Van Overshield got it there, but then Pierre started coming back and they got some three-pointers. There's Christofferson. And Seamson with another finish there.
Yeah, Ryan Berry stepping up here big today in the first half. 3 of 4 from the floor, 8 total points. And as we mentioned, Pierce really trying to do what they can to keep the ball out of Stabner's hands.
And likewise, Mitchell doing everything to keep the ball out of Terwilliger's hands. She only has 1 point, and that came on a free throw there. As you look at the turnovers, relatively even. Mitchell +4 in rebounding. Look at that, no free throws at all for Mitchell. Pierre 8 of 12, and Mitchell putting up more shots from the floor as well. With all sports, there are challenges that come along with it, and for a senior at Brandon Valley, one key challenge extends off the court.
The sounds of the game of basketball are familiar to the Althoff family.
You know, whether it's the PA announcers, you know, introducing the players. The cheerleaders leading the cheers. It's been something that has kind of resonated with us, I think, here these last few years for sure.
The Althoffs' love of the game continued on with all of their children, including the youngest, Josh.
My brothers always played growing up, so I always went to their games and just had fun watching them, so I figured I'd play.
While Josh appreciates the game of basketball, he's got a greater appreciation for the sounds of the game, as he was born deaf.
Every newborn, it turns out, is screened for hearing. And when she did Josh's hearing screening, she did not find any vibrations or brain waves that he was hearing sound. So she let me know that she had serious concerns about significant hearing loss in both ears. And that was all the information we were given before he was discharged from the hospital. And that started us on our journey of having him evaluated and figuring out that he had a profound hearing loss.
With a lot of research and a new job opportunity for Brent in Memphis, Tennessee, the Althoffs were able to find a way for Josh to hear with a cochlear implant.
The blessing was that in Sioux Falls, there was a physician who would do the cochlear implant surgery, but he would not do it in Sioux Falls, and he'd only done 6 patients. When we got to Memphis, we got him to be seen by a physician who had implanted over 160 kids. And it was the surgery ended up being at the Children's Hospital, and he was able to get both sides implanted at once.
We did a lot of research, considered the impact of, raising, a son through the deaf community versus, the cochlear implant option. And, it wasn't an easy decision. We didn't know what was truly best for him, but having older brothers, we just felt that, the cochlear implant would be a better option for our family and, trusted in God.
I'm definitely happy that they did, because without it, there's a lot of things about my life that would have been different, a lot of things that I wouldn't have been able to do. So I'm definitely happy for sure.
Now Josh is leading the links on the hardwood with full hearing, as long as he's got his ears on.
You really don't notice it a whole lot. It might fall off once in a while if he gets hit hard on a foul or something like that, but the guys are good at relaying the information, making sure if he's on the other end of the court that they're saying it a second or third time closer to him, get the message passed. He's good at just looking and dialing in and reading lips like everybody should, but he's really learned that he's got to really have eye focus and make sure he's doing that. But man, the expectations are just the same, and Josh wouldn't have it any other way.
Just that as long as you got the right attitude and the right work ethic, they can't really hold you back. It means a lot, because without the cochlear implants, I wouldn't be able to hear that. And it just reminds me that it's kind of a gift that I've been given, so I'm very thankful for it.
SDPB recently produced a program entitled Tales from the Hardwood, which featured Josh's story and others. Go to sdpb.org/basketball and watch Tales from the Hardwood today. And Brandon Valley is in the boys' state basketball tournament. They'll tip off on Thursday, the 14th, against Huron. We'll take a break and come back with more from the girls' basketball tournament. Class AA is right here on SDPB3.
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actegra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actegra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do, and that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
Goodness.
Seriously?
We're trying to promote the Descendants of Doom tour, trying to make everybody look kind of metal and,
Menacing.
The band just got covered by Delta Dental, so they kind of can't stop smiling.
They need to look more metal, and they don't look metal. What do we do?
Pop off a few more, see what we get.
Give me some metal.
All right, yeah. 3, 2, 1.
Delta Dental!
We're all going somewhere, going higher, faster, farther, going in new directions, to new places. At Monument Health, we keep going so you can keep going. We're dedicated to advanced orthopedic care with the latest innovations, technology, expertise, and treatment. So keep exploring, keep making memories, keep going with Monument Health as your partner. Learn more at monument.health/orthopedics.
Getting ready for the second half of basketball between Pierre and Mitchell, the battle for fifth place here at the girls' AA basketball tournament. Along with Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toome. Pierre up by 2 points. Nate, what do both teams have to do to be successful in the second half?
With Mitchell, you just feel like they're going to need to free Sawyer Stavner up here a little bit. If Pierre's going to really try to do what they can, to face guard and deny her. We saw her make that one crafty good back cut. There's just going to be something to provide her some space, run some set actions, some screens for her, get the basketball in her hands. As far as Pierre is concerned, continuing to lock in defensively on her, offensively, take care of the basketball. And you could really say that for both groups, with both of them having a double-figure amount of turnovers right here. You just kind of feel like who's ever to take care of it better in the second half is probably going to have success.
Stabner held to just 2 points in that first half for Mitchell, where she has scored 20 and 24 respectively in the previous two games. Meanwhile, Terwilliger held to 1 point. She scored 16 and 21 respectively in the previous two games. So let's see if either of those standout players can get going in the second half.
Yeah, Terwilliger's drawn a ton of attention, just like Stabner is for Mitchell. Every time she touches the ball deep, she's got multiple bodies around her. And when that happens, you just, especially as a big who's not touching it a ton on the perimeter, you just need to make the right basketball play. Somebody else is going to be open. Somebody's going to have a wide open shot or a closeout situation that they can attack.
Taylor to trigger it in, and we are underway with the third quarter. Pierre's going to take a quick shot. Dupree misses the three, and there's Stabner hauling down the rebound. Van Overshield to the corner and White. Quick bounce pass broken up by Taylor.
That first offensive possession, they put Dupree in a few screener situations with her setting back screens and her popping to the three. And it's hard to guard defensively because you got to help initially on that screen. Provides her some space.
Traveling. Stabner got a little out of control. Good defense by Pierre. Turnover, Kernels.
Yeah, the key if you're Stabner is when you do touch it, you understand the attention that you're drawn. You don't want to force things. You want to play within yourself, play your game like we've seen from her the entire tournament thus far.
They'll lob it into the paint. There's Terwilliger, partially blocked with a foul. Myrink, only her first foul of the second half, and Terwilliger back at the line, one of two on the day.
There's times where Mitchell is putting Carson Weick on Terwilliger, and they know and understand. Naturally, you'd think that Myrink might be a better matchup, but they know and understand that they're coming with that double team, and there she came down from the top with good length, just got a piece of the hand.
Got one of two, 2 points on the afternoon. Terwilliger averages 15 and a half, and over six rebounds a game. Seamson in trouble in the backcourt, bailed out by Van Overshield. Pass forward to Weick. And here's Stabner. Myrick, oh, what a pass.
Great execution there. Hit the high post. Top down with the bounce pass.
Berry working against the pressure will be bailed out by Dupree.
Both teams have struggled a bit handling that full court, even just man-to-man pressure. There's been a couple pickpockets and a couple deflections. And
yeah, the defense has been stellar for both teams, really all 94 feet of the court. Dupree with the right hand, yes. She has seven.
The offhand finish by Lennox Dupree gets the bump in the bucket.
Van Overshield right at the timeline. Good ball movement. Stabner scores. Give her four on the afternoon. Berry quickly the other way with a head of steam, but just doesn't have the numbers.
It's going to open up some chances for Stabner with Pierre pressing and sitting in a zone at times.
Dupree handles in the corner, won't take the shot. Berry's open for three. Yes! Ryan Berry coming alive with 11 points. She was held in check the first couple of games.
Playing with a lot more confidence offensively, Berry is right now.
Stabner, that one is tipped away and into the hands of Dupree.
That number's running up ahead.
Oh, but Dupree lost the handle. Got it away to Christofferson. Here's Berry that's open. She'll call up the play. And remember, Berry got her pocket picked a couple of times early, but yet she's bounced back well. And you mentioned playing with confidence. Terwilliger, that pass was off the mark coming in from Taylor. Turnover for Pierre.
They were trying to run an action. They sent Dupree off to the left off a baseline stagger, threw back to the right wing, and Terwilliger was ducking in big and deep, just couldn't execute the pass.
Here's a pass ahead. White catches up with it. Thought about a three. Looking for a teammate. Finds Kirsch in the corner now. Settled down with Seamson at the head of the lane. Oh, look out. Kirsch hit the deck hard. And we're going to have a foul, and that is going to be on Kristofferson. Timeout on the court. First foul on Kristofferson. We'll take a break. 4-point lead for Pierre. Back with more in a moment on SDPB3.
We all need insurance to protect our health, our homes, our belongings, and our businesses. But coverage is just the beginning. You also need the support of professionals who stand by your side to protect what's important to you. Fisher Rounds and Associates combines the coverage you want with the commitment you need. Fisher Rounds and Associates, at your service, at your side.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation. So we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
And we are back at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls. Fifth place game, Class AA girls basketball. Pierre with the 4-point lead on Mitchell. Along with Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toome. So far fouls, team fouls, one each here in the third quarter of play.
Yeah, and they're trying to isolate Stabner right at the high post area.
Guarded by Kristofferson, nothing there. Stabner picked up her dribble, five count underway, it's tipped away. And we're gonna have a foul on Kristofferson, and that is quickly her second.
Kristofferson's physical presence on Stabner is not leaving her side too often.
Seamson open for a three. No, rebound Kristofferson. She'll take one dribble and then give way to Barry. Oh, player hitting the deck, that's Seamson. Taylor, no shot for her. Dupree's calling for it on the far side of the court. There's Kristofferson at the elbow. Now Dupree has it on the right perimeter, and it's tapped away from her. Steal, here comes Mitchell. They've got numbers, but they don't press the advantage. Wyke outside. Peterson short. Rebound Dupree. But she lost the handle in the hands of Stabner. Wyke gives way. Seamson scores. She has 11.
This might be about as.
And Dupree will take an official timeout here for Dupree to tie her shoelaces.
Tie the shoes. Yep.
And that means Mitchell can make some subs. Van Overshield, Myrink in as Wyke and Stabner. Nope. Yeah, Stabner will get a break here. Don't see her come out of the game too often.
No, they're maybe trying to time it out, maybe with a quarter end or give her a quick blow before the fourth.
Oh, Dupree almost lost it. Van Overshield making it tougher to get it up court. And there we're gonna have a foul, and that's gonna be on, I believe, Myrink.
This might be more open court deflections and open court steals than I've seen in a long time in this game, Steve. Both teams are harassing the ball handler, and they're really not doing a whole lot to help the ball handler, just clearing out and expecting them to beat the pressure.
Yep, another steal there. And look out, That's going to be out of bounds. Good sportsmanship there as Terwilliger helps Meyerink back up. Inadvertent contact. And Stabner didn't stay on the bench very long. She'll replace Seamson. So they're trying to rest their main playmakers, give them a little break here and there, keep at least one of their main playmakers on the court at all times. And we're going to have a foul, and that may be the third on Christofferson, and it is. She picks up three personal fouls quickly.
When the ball hits the baseline or the ball hits the corner and it appears in their half-court trap, that trap's going to come on a hurry. You got to make a quick decision, and there Meyerink gets a little fortunate as she tries to split it.
Too strong off the window for Stabner, and now we're going to have a foul on Peterson in the backcourt. And for Peterson, that's her second. And here comes Seamson in. She'll replace Kirsch. Wyke in to replace Peterson. So Seamson got just a little bit of a break.
Yep, they get their five, essentially their five starters back in the game.
Dupree. Yep, she'll scan the court as the pressure fades away. Trying to
there,
find
they
Terwilliger.
Got the mismatch. Yeah, they switched that ball screen. Do a nice job on the weak side. Meyerink switches it right back.
Here's a drive by Richter, and she scores. 4 points for her. And overshield all the way, and a foul, and two free throws coming up. Boy, this game's just physical. Players hitting the deck all over the place. Terwilliger, personal foul number two.
I think both these groups are used to that. And certainly you look at it, they got some big, strong athletes that I expect that, you know, back a number of years ago, weightlifting for basketball players wasn't a huge emphasis. But nowadays, I suspect that they all probably do some body weight stuff, toss around some different weights, and yeah, some good-looking athletes out there.
Yeah, not just the guys lifting the weights in the offseason. Ladies are too, and there's Dupree, too strong off the window. Numbers for Mitchell if they press it as Dupree's trailing the play. Stabner on the move across the lane and travel. Turnover, Mitchell.
Yeah, this is a product a little bit when you're Sawyer Stabner and the amount of attention that you draw, and you didn't touch the ball and you didn't get a whole lot going in that first half, and when you do touch it, you just feel like you're almost pressing a little bit and wanting to make something happen. Not a ton differently than what she normally plays like, but you just kind of sense that a bit from her here in this third quarter.
You know, SDPB recorded the state high school gymnastics competition last month. You can watch highlights featuring the top individual performances from each apparatus on March 17th at Sunday afternoon, 1 Central Noon Mountain Time. We present the high school state gymnastics competition. Again, Sunday, March 17th, 1 Central Noon Mountain Time, SDPB 1 Television. A busy time of year as gymnastics happened back in February. And, you know, there have been some athletes from South Dakota that have gone on to the next level in the gymnastics ranks. So
you'd be educating me there, Steve. I try to follow a lot of stuff, but gymnastics is not one I'm too keen on.
I believe a young lady from Rapid City Central, and I think it was her last name is Christensen, ended up at Missouri on a gymnastics scholarship.
Impressive.
And that is a top-notch program in the SEC. Dupree up court.
And there Dupree does a nice job. Just one quick hard move, then slam on the brakes. They're trying to set up a little back cut action.
The three is good by Dupree. Mitchell on the move. Van Overshield, the quick release, but that's going to be an air ball out of bounds.
A little deeper than probably what Van Overshield is used to shooting. She stopped there again behind that professional line and just extends out the shot another good 3.5 feet.
Dupree gets the ball in the backcourt. Guarded by Wyke. Now gives way to Barry. Picked up by Seamson. High post, it's tapped away from Twilliger, but she gets possession back, but then throws it right to Stabner. Turnover, Pierre. Stabner all the way, look out, players hitting the deck again, free throws coming up.
Big stop for Mitchell right there. Period converted on four of their last five possessions, and there Terwilliger just hits Stabner right in the hands, creates the transition chance and opportunity.
Richter with the foul, her first.
That looked like a safety reading the quarterback's eyes right there, Steve.
Yep.
Moving, and I think Sawyer Stabner might be able to play safety for a number of different football teams.
I think she has the athletic capability.
Yeah. In the mentality as well. Hard-hitting, strong safety.
Yeah, again, she reminds me so much of Sloan Masters, who I covered at Briar Cliff, who just had a strong player, played power forward, and, it was either power forward or fullback. Wasn't sure what, but she has reminds me in her game. And of course, Sloan was an All-American for Briar Cliff. Here's Barry.
Yeah, they're just grinding it, getting it to a third, fourth side. Good things can happen. Yeah.
Terwilliger.
They reverse the ball multiple times. Finally, free up Terwilliger.
That's her first bucket of the game. Meyerink backs down with the right hand. Nice touch off the window from Meyerink. She's got four.
Yeah, Stabner was fortunate there. May have gotten away with the travel.
There's a steal. Now Stabner underneath. Seamson finishes with the right hand as it spins around the world a couple of times. And one player's just hitting the deck. They're going to have to clean the floor afterwards. That may be on Stabner.
Only the fourth team foul, so those take it side out here. Shot clock's off. 31.9 remaining here in the third quarter.
Seamson's going to check out in favor of Peterson, and that foul instead was on Peterson, not Stabner. For Peterson, that's her third. Shot clock is off. Let's see if Pierre plays for the final opportunity. Near steal there, but Taylor handles it. Now Terwilliger, offensive foul. Stabner drawing the charge for Terwilliger, foul number three.
Phenomenal job of Stabner, sliding over, takes the outstretched arm of 15 Terwilliger right in the chest, easy call.
Now Stabner brings it up, guarded by Christofferson. Here comes the double team. 10 seconds left, still some time. Stabner on the move, up off the window. No, but there's Meyerink sneaking in. No, another chance. No, Stabner, yes, at the buzzer. It will count.
The fourth time's the charm.
Great offensive rebounding, and Mitchell goes into the final period of regulation with the lead. Back in a moment with more from the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament. You're watching SDPB3.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great, like 15 pizzas. Yo! Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
Bioethanol supplies more than just energy. It creates jobs in rural communities. It drives demand for local corn. It provides opportunities for family farms to thrive. To ensure agriculture plays a leading role in the efforts to decarbonize and transition energy, bioethanol remains at the forefront of a pursuit for a cleaner, brighter future for all Americans. Learn how at sdethanol.com.
Getting ready for the final period of regulation here between Mitchell and Pierre for fifth place at the girls AA basketball tournament. Along with Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toome. A flurry by Mitchell at the end sees them not only cut into the deficit, but got a jump ball here, but they got the lead. And some good offensive rebounding right at the end of the quarter.
Good competitive ball game here, back and forth. Both teams playing really hard. One team wants to end their season on a win here.
Christofferson with a big smile on her face, but oh, it's tipped and stolen by Mitchell. Seamson goes down low, Stabner spins. Here's a driving Van Overshield, too strong off the window to Williger. Outlet, Taylor on the move for the Governors. Races around everybody and scores.
Meyernick was trying to backpedal and stay in front of the quick little Gracelyn Taylor, but slides her way through.
Cross court pass, Van Overshield. Seamson, long three, yes.
A pretty left-handed stroke by Addie Seamson.
She's got 16. That was beyond the pro arc there. Mitchell by two.
Trading blows here, both teams.
It was a one-point contest. Mitchell won during the regular season, 49-48. Could we see a repeat one-point performance? Shot, I wouldn't be surprised.
Shot clock under 10.
Dupree pull up, Jay, no. Van Overshield the rebound. Long outlet, Seamson. Through the lane, up and no good, and Terwilliger clears the rebound.
Seamson actually had Meyernick on that circle under off the middle drive. There's Christofferson thinking about it.
No, Stabner with the rebound. She'll slow things down. She was a lot more open than she thought initially, and that hesitation, but there's Taylor tapping it away. Gets around to the defender, had it blocked. Pulls it back out. Now Barry puts it up off the window and scores. Barry has 13. Timeout Pierre with 5:57 left. 30-second timeout.
Gracelyn Taylor making an impact with her speed, athleticism, defensive prowess, and there again, both teams right now. Mitchell 18 turnovers, Pierre 19 turnovers. The ability to handle the basketball, dribble, catch, pass, be able to maximize your chances is huge coming down the stretch here.
Mitchell, 15 of 37 from the floor, 41%. Pierre, an even 50% at 12 of 24. 3-point field goals, 4 of 10 for Pierre, 3 of 15 for Mitchell. From the free throw line, Mitchell is 4 of 4. 9 of 14 at the charity stripe for the Governors. As we are tied at 37.
Yeah, and a couple of the big guns have been Stabner up to 8, Terwilliger 6, but relatively quiet. We got some other folks that are stepping up, making plays here today.
Yeah, it has been just a knockdown, drag-out affair here so far. So we get back to action. Stabner brings it up. Lost the handle. Got it back. Three on the way. No. Rebound taken away by Barry. Who will step up in the final 5 minutes and change for their respective club?
Here, slowing it down. Looking at Lennox off a flare screen right inside to Terwilliger. Another one of their favorite actions. They run multiple things to get Terwilliger ducking in, a deep paint touch where they can't get that double there in time. Well executed.
And a timeout called by Mitchell.
Yeah, it's so hard when you have an effective post player like Terwilliger and she catches that deep. You have no time to bring an extra body, no time to bring that double or that dig, and it just becomes a catch right into your finish. And that's why as a coach, you're constantly looking for ways when you got a good post player, and they don't grow on trees.
Nope.
But when you got one that you can throw it into, you got to come up with some different ways to make sure you're utilizing them.
You know, the game has changed so much where the importance of a post player seems to have diminished at all levels, in the pros and the college ranks. In the high school, you still need to have that post player if you want, or somebody to play that five position, if you will. You know, I just think about this, where you look at a lot of teams, they play three, four guards, even five guards at time, because it has gone more to the perimeter throughout the course of the years.
No question. The prowess of the three-pointer and how prevalent, and frankly, how skilled people are nowadays and comfortable shooting it, but you still need to, the biggest thing is getting the ball, collapsing the defense, getting it in the paint, and a post touch is obviously still a great way to do so.
Taylor with the steal. And Barry has trouble handling it, and a jump ball possession arrow favors Mitchell. Timeout on the court, 4:45 left to go here in the fourth quarter. Pierre leads by two. Back in a moment right here on SDPB3.
You're committed to building relationships, to exceeding expectations, to serving your community. Your financial partner should share your vision and your values. For 130 years, we've stood by South Dakotans. We've been there, we'll be there. Convenient, connected, committed. Bank West, member FDIC.
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actagra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actagra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do. And that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
There you go, look at the Mitchell student section. Easy to identify them with the black and gold. They always bring a big crowd, as does Pierre every time they're on the road. They're wearing the Kelly green and white today. Along with Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toom. We're at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls, Heritage Court. Fifth place on the line between Pierre and Mitchell. Currently Pierre with the edge at 39-37.
Neither one of these groups, players, coaches, fans, maybe fans more than anything, want to lose to the other.
And a foul on the perimeter, and that's going to be on Taylor, and that is her second. That is the first foul on either team here in this quarter. Hard to believe it, considering all the players that have been hitting the deck time and time again. And over Shield gives way to Stabner. Down low, Meyerink. And I think she's going to be tied up. Oh, look out. Jump ball.
One of Mitchell's favorite actions right there, with a wing enter and a quick back screen from Myronick coming to the ball side. And there she couldn't go right up and finish, and Mitchell ties her up. Or excuse me, Pierre ties it up.
Myronick heading to Dakota Wesleyan. Golf and basketball. Plans on participating in those. If you saw her when she was introduced, she had a little golf swing as she came out with the hype woman. And there is Dupree missing the three. Terwilliger went over the back.
Peterson does a great job. When you give up a little size, a little strength, the low person's going to win. She did a great job getting into Terwilliger's legs and had to be a push in the back.
Seamson in, Peterson out for the Colonels. Coming down the wire, anybody's game as Stabner gets the inbounds. Weick across the paint, finds Van Overshield. No on the three. And I think we're going to have a foul on Mitchell, and we will.
It was the right person that you want taking that shot from Mitchell. Weick did a good job. Sawyer, Stabner with the pitch ahead. Weick with the hard attack. Clean look, just a little bit too long.
Stabner got her third personal foul. Comes at under 4 minutes to go. We're at 3:43 and counting. Dupree handling it. Barry open for a moment. Now Taylor in the corner. Skip pass. Barry, three. Yes.
That's her second one from that spot on the court. She likes that left wing.
5-point lead. Stabner all the way under. Gave it to Van Overshield, and she scores as everyone was kind of confused there, I think. They were thinking there was going to be a travel. Dupree lobs it to the middle of the court, and Christofferson breaks the pressure. Here comes Barry. She'll put it on the floor, get around a player, reverse layup, scores. Ryan Barry taking control here.
Slippery with the baseline drive and the reverse finish.
And that's out of bounds. Terwilliger tapped it into the Pierre bench. Pierre fans on their feet. And Mitchell wants a timeout. They will have three left, two timeouts left for Pierre. Pierre up by five.
Ryan Barry been gigantic here this afternoon for Pierre. 16 points, 6 of 7 from the floor. Efficient, 2 of 3 from the three-point line and 6 boards. She's been a huge contributor.
Well, we got a moment. I want to tell you about a podcast that you need to listen to. It's called In Play with Craig Maddock. It features in-depth discussions about all things sports in South Dakota. And through these conversations, we learn about the players, the programs, and the legends who helped shape the current sports landscape here in the Mount Rushmore State. You can find the podcast on Apple, Google, Spotify, and wherever you get your podcasts. And be sure to leave us a 5-star review so that others are able to find it. In Play with Craig Maddock. We are so fortunate to have Craig be part of these sports broadcasts here at SDPB on the air and with the in-play podcast.
No question. Much like yourself, Steve, a pro's pro, and the listeners and the fans around this area are blessed to have you two, us analysts that just get to sit here and talk every once in a while. You guys make it pretty easy.
I do appreciate it, and I tell you what, we have a good crew here at SDPB, and it's a pleasure to work with all the people in our production department, engineering, and operations. There's a lot of people behind the scenes that make this happen. As we get back to action, as Stabner drives across the lane, there's the open shooter. White gets off the mark, and there's Barry flying in with the rebound. Outlet, Dupree, they've got numbers. Not the angle for a pass, and Dupree's going to circle around and slow it down. Oh, but throws it behind Barry. Chased down by Wyke. And then Meyrink with the finish.
Wyke with a tremendous, knowledgeable play right there. Pierre kind of checked up, thinking that it was going to be an over-the-back call as Wyke just sprints right by everybody.
Wyke could have turned around and put it in, but she didn't see that there was nobody between her and the basket. Pass up top to Terwilliger. That pass is tipped away by White, but Dupree tracks it down.
Pierre was up 5, had a possession right there. Just an unforced turnover, and this game changed in a hurry. There's Dupree.
Oh. Ew, in and out. Mitchell down by 3, 90 seconds to go. Stabner hit the deck. Van Overshield, ooh, lost the handle almost. Stabner to the corner. White, three-pointer, no! Rebound controlled by Terwilliger. And they're going to get a foul, trying to get the tie-up. Both teams a lot of fouls to give here.
Yeah, only Mitchell's second team foul, so it'll allow them to set up their full-court press, stay really aggressive here. Still only a one-possession game. You can play this out plenty of time.
That foul was on Stabner. That's her fourth. Dupree across the timeline. Here's Terwilliger in the high post. Great to have a 6'2 player if you can have come out and handle the ball in a high post to help break the pressure.
Yeah, very nice pressure release to have when they're trapping or you're getting heated up with pressure. Here their shot clock's under 10.
Lost the handle. And I think Barry's going to get called for a foul, and she will. That is her second. Third team foul. Only 2 team fouls on Mitchell with 45.3 seconds left. So free throws not going to be a factor here as at least on a floor foul, shooting foul, different situation. Mitchell calls a full timeout.
Yeah, Coach Brooks is still plenty of time here. Obviously down three, one possession game, but you can get the best shot that you can. You can take a quick two here, even if it takes a little while, and then you got to be super aggressive. Certainly do not need a three, but if you can create a open three like they've had a few different times with the attention that Stabner draws, for sure, obviously you're going to take that as well. And then you just need to know exactly what the situation is. We hit a three, tie game. We're just sitting back and defend it. We score our two. Obviously, it's got to be heightened ball pressure and trying to create a turnover and a steal as quickly as we can.
Mitchell only two team fouls. So they have two fouls to give before they send Pierre to the free throw line. Pierre, they have three team fouls. Timeout situation, two for each. You look at some of the Mitchell fans here. This one coming down to the wire as it did during the regular season.
Who's surprised by this, Steve? I don't think anybody
and
right
nobody
here.
Nobody's surprised.
Lower score, a bit of a lower scoring affair, which both these teams are certainly used to, and a tight physical game. Fun to watch.
Near half court, Mitchell will play it in. They get it to Stabner. Van Overshiel, let's see the play they want. Stabner wants it. Kristofferson right on her. Backdoor cut, Van Overshiel scores.
Very nicely done. Great execution. Doesn't look at the first back screen, hits the second one. Here they are in their full court pressure.
They've got to get it across the timeline, and here's a foul. Van Overshiel commits the foul, but that's only the third team foul on Mitchell.
Yeah, and you gotta make sure you're up here, not allowing an easy touch, but Mitchell's kind of hanging back with a couple of them.
They get it to Dupree, now quickly back to Barry. And there's Van Overshiel, that's her fourth personal foul. So that was the last one they had to give with 19.9 seconds left. Now you don't want to have Van Overshiel or Stabner commit the foul because both of them have four personal fouls. Dupree gets the inbounds bumped right away by a couple of players, and I think it's going to be Wyke that gets that foul.
Yeah, as a coach, you generally want to try to, in a defensive possession like that, try to get those two off the floor knowing that you're going to foul and there'll be a substitution available for you. But they also happen to be two of their more athletic, quicker players that can do a good job trying to force a turnover. So there they were fortunate at didn't wind up in either one of their players' hands.
Two free throws upcoming. First one's good, 11 for Dupree. Either way, it'll be a one possession game. Mitchell, two timeouts left. Pierre, two timeouts left. Pierre has a foul to give. Which means they can take some chances on defense, and a timeout is called by Mitchell. They will have one remaining.
There again with 18 seconds left, if you can bust it quick down the floor, there's still time to get your quick deuce. If you choose to go that route or just choose to attack the paint and then see if the defense can make a mistake and converge and leave one of your shooters open. Certainly defensively from Pierre, this is too much time. When you get low, you get into the situation, which is now plenty common, those foul and defense situations when you're up three. And when you can kind of force them to just go to the free throw line if there's low time. But with 18 seconds left on the clock, that's way too much time to extend the game like that. So Pierre's just going to sit down. But you want to be sure that you're trying to force them to take as much time off this clock as possible.
Terwilliger with four fouls, Kristofferson with three for Pierre. Pierre does have a foul to give. 3-pointage for Pierre. For Mitchell, do you go for the quick three or do you extend the game? That is the question. Dave Brooks sends out his troops. He's got his starters on the court. Here also, they're starting five on the court. Seamson throws it in. Stabner chased by Kristofferson. She's going to the rim, and she will score the quick two. And a timeout, I believe, has been called by Pierre. Yes, they will call the timeout. So Stabner gets her 10th point of the afternoon, and Pierre calls the timeout. You figure Mitchell would have, but Pierre calls the timeout. They have one left, so they probably want to set up the inbounds play.
You're going to have to help me out with this one, Steve, but in high school, the clock doesn't stop, right? So the clock would have just kept going for their 5 seconds off the make, right? I know at the college level, under a minute, it stops. I guess at the high school level, we're gonna have to check in on that one.
We will have to investigate.
It doesn't matter now as Pierre took that immediate timeout. But sometimes if the clock's not going to stop, you just let the ball take your time as you're gathering the basketball and burn all the seconds that you can get. And then if you want to take a timeout, take it with 8 seconds left and not 13. But.
All right, here we go. It's a one-point game. Shades of the regular season where it was a one-point game. Pierre, the length of the floor to go. And he fouled by Mitchell, sends the Governors to the line for two. Myrick drops back deep to prevent the long pass.
They're allowing Terwilliger to get an easy touch here, but they want Dupree.
Yep, and there's the quick foul. Let's see who that's on. It's against Stabner, she's gone. But I don't think so.
Yeah, that was the same action that they ran yesterday. They put Dupree on the ball side. She takes a couple hard steps like she's breaking down the floor and just comes back to the ball.
Simpson just got her fourth foul for Mitchell. Dupree at the line, two big free throws. It's a two-point game.
And as you mentioned, Pierce still does have their foul to give. So as they're dribbling that ball down the court, regardless of whether you're up two, up three, could take that and burn a few more seconds.
Mm-hmm. Clutch by Lennox Dupree. Here come the Colonels, down by three. 10 seconds left. Van Overshield. Oh, before the shot, the timeout called. Oh, my. Dave Brooks spends his final timeout before the shot went up.
Probably a good thing there, because I think that shot got deflected and was going to wind up a little bit short. But here again, we've already said it, 7 seconds left. You got to foul the give. The challenging thing is you just can't give it on the shooting motion.
Yes.
So as a coach, you're talking to them that force them to catch it going away from the rim, which they probably will be when they need a three here with 7 seconds, and then take it immediately on the catch. But if they're facing the basket, that's where it can get a little challenging.
Simpson went over to the trainer. Looks like she might have a bloody nose, as they were working on her rather quickly to get her back in the lineup. She's one of their best three-point shooters, 33% on the year, and has two of them this afternoon.
And that was the last timeout for Mitchell here as well. So this is going to be it.
And if Pierre can get their hands on the basketball, they could call timeout before a jump ball because they got one left. Here it goes. Stabner, they'll let her drive and they'll let her score, and the clock's just gonna run out, and it's gonna be 48-47. Pierre wins the fifth place trophy. As you were right, the clock did run after the make.
And Stabner was just, she was trying to get that quick two. And she actually had a couple shooters on the weak side, but I tell you what, Mitchell does not have the season that they had, and they don't, frankly, probably reach anywhere near this point without Sawyer Stabner. She certainly has nothing to hang her head about, because she's one of the best players in the state, and she's proven it time in and time again.
What a contest. 1 point during the regular season, Mitchell won it. Here at the state tournament, 1 point differential. Pierre wins fifth place and they will go home with the consolation championship trophy. The teams line up, and in a moment, we'll turn things over to Greg Thompson, our public address announcer, and he will hand out the awards to the sixth place team Mitchell and the fifth place team Pierre. What a game we've had today on SDPB 3. Let's turn it over to Greg.
Good afternoon, fans. We'd like to present the awards to the teams that played for fifth and sixth. Presenting the awards from the South Dakota High School Activity Association Board of Directors, Ryan Rollinger. Assisting with the team awards presentation are representatives from the Activity Association's corporate partners, from Sanford Health, John Sarda, from Farmers Union Insurance, Stacy Monger, and from the South Dakota National Guard, Staff Sergeant Kaylee Sheehawk. We'll start with sixth place, the Colonels of Mitchell. Number four, London Hayek. Number five, London Schroeder. Number 11, Matea Graves. Number 12, Lauren Van Overshield. Number 13, Tally Pashong. Number 14, Sawyer Stabner. Number 20, Delaney Dagan. Number 23, Carson Wyke. Number 24, Charlie Collins. Number 30, Maddie Kemp. Number 32, Addie Simpson. Number 33, Mackenzie Peterson. Number 42, Allison Meyerink. Number 44, Brianna Kirsch. Managers, Cassidy Knipling, Bailey Lopez Morales, and Audrey Miller. Assistant coaches, Mackenzie Mertens, Christina Simpson, and Wes Morgan. And accepting the award for sixth place, head coach of the Colonels, Dave Brooks. And now the award for fifth place goes to the Governors of Pierre. Number zero, Brianna Sargent. Number two, Jasmine Jost. Number three, Elise Christofferson. Number four, Lavin Price. Number five, Molly Olson. Number 10, Lennox Dupree. Number 13, Ryan Berry. Number 15, Reese Terwilliger. Number 20, Gracelyn Taylor. Number 22, Bryn Stoser. Number 23, Grace Richter. Number 24, Addison Soma. Number 34, Taylan Cass. Number 35, Mackenzie Flatmeyer. And number 41, Paige Sporer. Managers, Jenna Buckles, Ava Doyle, Melanie Lamb, Reese Ludow, Jordan Mayer, and Taryn Sproul. Assistant coaches, Terry Becker, Carice Blanchette, and Jeff Sheckleway. Accepting the trophy for fifth place, head coach Kirk Bebout. Ladies and gentlemen, your Governors of Pierre, T.F. Riggs.
And congratulations to Pierre. They claim the consolation championship here at the girls AA basketball tournament. Back with more in a moment right here on SDPB3.
You live life on the move. While you determine what direction that may be, we're here to help along the way. So go. Go with values. Go with friends. Go with support. Go with convenience.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Lucky for us, life is full of choices, big and small, just as it should be. They define us, make us who we are. And when it comes time for you to choose, a car, home, your next big adventure, or start a new business, Farmers Union Insurance has the variety of choices to make sure you have the perfect coverage to protect each perfect moment. Farmers Union Insurance.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
We expected a hard-fought, knockdown, drag-out contest. That's exactly what we got. Pierre prevails over Mitchell, 48-47 for fifth place. Let's check out these second half highlights. Good ball movement there by Mitchell as Meyering got the finish, and then Dupree with the offhand finish.
Yeah, Dupree finished with 14, Barry 16. Both those two key cogs in this afternoon's victory.
Seamson led the way with 16. For Mitchell. What a great game there. That shot by Richter, who provided a big spark off the bench.
Yeah, that was a big three from Dupree right there in the corner. Put him up five, I believe. And this game, yeah, back and forth affair, and one team just had to run out of time.
That was the end of the third quarter. That flurry there of offensive rebounds led to a bucket by Mitchell, but Taylor, she played a great game today defensively and got some key buckets.
Yeah, Pierre had different people stepped up. They didn't play a ton of bodies, but the ones that did were very influential.
It's about making plays at the key moments, and really I think it just Pierre made one more key play. Turnover is a big factor in today's game. Both of them turned the ball over a lot, 42 combined turnovers. Rebounding relatively even, free throws an edge for Pierre. Three-point shooting, kind of a wash there for both teams. Pierre made a couple of more. Mitchell had more shots from the floor that went in, but in the end, it was Pierre just kind of making that one play. And you mentioned that three-pointer by Dupree. That might have been the difference in this particular contest.
Yeah, Pierre also did a nice job of getting to the foul line, too. They had a few late where Mitchell had to, but even prior to that, they were attacking the lane and forcing the officials to give them the calls. And yeah, got there 18 times.
We'll take a break. We'll set you up for tonight after this timeout on SDPB3.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great, like 15 pizzas. Yo! Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
Our teams are committed to improving quality of life in our communities. Whether we're planning construction concepts, building a new downtown development, bringing new businesses to our communities, or maintaining your apartment home. We believe everyone deserves a well-built and well-managed place to live and work. This is Lloyd.
Oh my goodness.
I decided to switch my major. I didn't want to do sports anymore, so I decided Southeast Tech would be a good one for me to go. The current instructor is a captain with the Highway Patrol. He had a lot of experience and knowledge about the job. I serve the people just as much as they serve me.
SDPB brings you the South Dakota Boys State Basketball Tournament. You can catch all the action Thursday, March 14th through Saturday, March 16th. For more information, including multiple ways to watch the games live, go to sdpb.org/basketball. Complete coverage of the South Dakota Boys State Basketball Tournament is brought to you by Dakota Bank and SD Corn.
.48-47, the final score in the fifth place game. Pierre prevails over Mitchell, so that takes care of things for the consolation bracket, and it sets us up for tonight. Championship Saturday night here at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls. We'll start things off at 6 Central, 5 Mountain Time. Jefferson taking on Harrisburg for third place, and then we roll into the championship game. Brandon Valley, the 3 seed, will try to knock off unbeaten and number one ranked O'Gorman in the title tilt. All the action here on SDPB 3. I tell you what, Nate, it ought to be a fantastic night.
It is, yeah. As we said yesterday, 4 area teams, and better get here early. And we got our last game. We got the teams that are, at least at this point in the year, playing the best basketball in the state. I'm confident in saying that, and it's going to be must-see TV.
Yep, earlier today, Spearfish prevailed over Stevens, 59-50. You just saw Pierre beat Mitchell. That was for fifth place. Spearfish takes seventh place, third place in the championship game coming up tonight. On behalf of our engineering operation and production crew, for Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toombs, signing off temporarily from the Pentagon here in Sioux Falls. We'll see you.